Holy crap.
People persist in doubting the evidence.
Don't run and hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. The truth will set you free.
You're listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Halloween week. How do you do it? What's up, everybody? How you doing? Yeah. Oh, fun, relaxing weekend. It's all good. Trust me. This is Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today's Monday, October 27th. The kickoff of Halloween week. We are 297 days into the new year. As always, we are live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here, downtown Burbank, California. For KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network, I am your so humble host, Jimmy Church. How you doing? Yeah, happy Monday. Let's go. Let's get this one cracking. Halloween week. You know what that means. Nightmares are coming. I like a good dream. Good scary dream. See if we can facilitate that tonight. Linda Godfrey is going to be with us. Monsters in America. Big salute to the proud men and women in uniform all around the world, fighting the good fight for us, protecting that Constitution, allowing me to do this show and hang out with you every single night. Podcast all updated. Doing a good job with that. Thank you, everybody. Best $2 you ever spent. Love that movie. I was over at faders.org today. And I got to tell you, I think we're going to shift gears. When I do the news here, we'll scrap ISIS. We'll scrap Swedish submarines in the Baltic. We'll scrap all of that. Ebola. And I'm just going to read the headlines right off of faders.org. Over there before the show. Check this out. Faders.org right now. We've got, you know, articles around the Faderverse. Aliens, they're not that into you. That's one. Synchronicity. Psychoid and spiders. Unusual photos. These are headlines. Portals. We're going to talk about that tonight with Linda. This is from my childhood. That's from Donna Colvin. If the Air Force stopped investigating UFOs, you saw that, the MUFON star training. That was a great, great story, actually, what happened out there with, you know, they set up this crashed UFO mock-up out in the desert. Looked pretty cool, too. I don't know who put it together, but pretty convincing. So a private plane flies by. I'm not, you know, I shouldn't even give away the article. You should go check it out, but you know, a little whatever, Cessna 150 cruises by, pilot freaks out, does a little circle, dips his wings, checks it out. And then the next thing you know, 20 minutes later, some F-16s are buzzing the crash site, a couple of them. Then a police helicopter cruises by, goes down to 50 feet to check it out. Hence the headline, I thought the Air Force didn't investigate anymore. Well, all of these headlines, all of these stories are over at faders.org. And Mike Barrett tweeted the other day, he said, so I need a one-stop shop every day for my UFO fix. Where do I go? I said, dude, faders.org. He's like, done. I think that's what he meant when he tweeted back. It's that cool. Go and check it out. Faders.org. Become a member. Hang out. Great, great community. Awesome. I'm ready. You guys ready? I haven't even gone over to Twitter yet. I did my little tweet before the show. So let me retweet some hot stuff. What's going on? Everybody here? Is everybody here? I see most of the usual suspects. I am scrolling through. Welcome to everybody listening across the United States, all around the world. What you want to do, come hang out on Twitter with us. The Twitterverse. Twitter Nation. Fader Nation. Did I just say that? That's so passe. I was thinking about that the other day. Fader Nation. So passe. So last year. Fader family. I don't even know what to call it now. But everybody is here. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Hashtag DM Radio Net. That'll yank you right into the sandbox. Come on over. Hang out with us. Great bunch of people. The best. And they're very smart. Very smart. Over on YouTube, check this out. Kind of a weird day. With something that's never promoted or, you know, really talked about or anything. But we crossed 700,000 views today for, you know, this little show. 700,000 views. We're at over 6,000 subscribers on something that's never been promoted. It just kind of just sits there and does its own thing. But in a week or two, we're going to cross a million views, a million. Wow. The Fader Bunch. I like that. The Fader Bunch. Robert, that's good stuff right there. The Fader Bunch. I like that. I actually like that. Everybody's thinking Brady Bunch. I'm not. I'm thinking the Wild Bunch. That's where I go with that. That's my polluted mind. Tonight, it's Linda Godfrey. Monsters, demons, Bigfoot, stuff that goes bump in the night. Linda Godfrey will be joining us at the bottom of the hour. Tomorrow, Father Ashcraft, exorcisms. He's no joke, by the way. Wednesday, Tracy Twyman, and for some Ouija board stuff. And we might even, we're looking to close this. I think we'll get it done. We might have a special guest on with or after Tracy. It's whatever Tracy wants to do. And we might do some live Ouija with a video feed. Yeah. The only reason why I'm doing it is the Ouija board will not be here in the studio. That's the only reason. Caller readings on Thursday, yes, with Sha, the good witch. She'll be with us all night on Thursday, taking your calls, doing readings all night. Something I've never done. Mucho requested here. And what a better night than Thursday night before Halloween. I was almost tempted to do a Halloween show on Friday night, but I got to give away candy over at the pad. Whoa, whoa. And I got to. So I was so tempted. I just thought, who is going to be here with us on Halloween? Nobody. The answer is nobody. But so anyway, Thursday night, readings all night on Thursday. It's going to be really cool. Tonight, I will be taking your calls with Linda Godfrey, 323-825-5045. We'll do that in the last segment. As always, you can email throughout the show, jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. You can go over to the contact page over on the website, jimmychurchradio.com. Go to the contact page. You can email us there in confidence, where we use non-NSA special encrypted service. All right. Man, it's so good to be here. Had a really good weekend. father-in-law's birthday, dad, yesterday, 83 years old, dancing up a storm. We're over at a Greek restaurant in Sherman Oaks. Lit it up last night. Oh, man, what a great time. So happy birthday to Pops. And then on Friday night, we went out again. So Friday night was we had our in-laws, brother-in-law's 30th anniversary surprise bash. Posted pictures of that, too, on Facebook. I couldn't help myself. It was a personal surprise thing. I couldn't help myself. Couldn't help myself. But that was our weekend. So we relaxed and just cruised through the weekend. And here we are today, so fired up. And Halloween week is just going to be smoking. If you have any questions for Linda, that is hashtag F2BQ. Hashtag F2BQ. It's my own little column over there on TweetDeck. Feeds right in here to the studio. Okay? All right? I think that's got everything set up. I got the Larry Warren, you know, Rendlesham Larry Warren. He is the man. Sent me this quote. And I had to post it. I have to read it. Okay? You ready? Hearing a cocktail being shaken is my second favorite sound in the world. My first favorite sound is that of a Harley Davidson motorcycle. That quote is from Dan Aykroyd. What a quote. Today, Judas Priest guitarist K.K. Downing, 63 years old, ladies and gentlemen. 63 years old. K.K. Downing. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. 63. Love my Starbucks. Today, actor John Cleese, 75 years old. Singer frontman Scott Weiland, 47, Stone Temple Pilots. And before anybody asks me to tell a Scott Weiland story, this is a family show. That would be nothing but trouble. And today, Duran Duran's Simon Le Bon, 56 years old. Now, for Twitter, I want to light this up one of two ways. First, I'm going on the record right now. Duran Duran kicked major booty. Loved that band. As hardcore as this man is, speaking into the microphone, Duran Duran ruled. So what is your favorite Duran Duran song? I have one. I have one that is miles above the rest. And I'm just wondering how long it's going to take for somebody to tweet that in. And I will chime in when it hits. This particular song, my favorite, their producer gave me, this is probably 20 years ago, gave me, while they were in the studio, gave me a CD of four mixes of this song. Four. And it's autographed in gold by everybody. It's one of my prized possessions. Rio, good song. I'm looking. I'm watching. Hungry Like the Wolf. Smoking. Yep. Girls on Film. I'm watching tweet. I'm watching this light up. I get it. Hungry Like the Wolf is. Is there something I should know? Good. Justin. Ordinary World. Justin came in first. I've got four mixes of Ordinary World. With and without vocals, with and without percussion, with and without string. I mean, just all these different versions of it. And I think one of them is like 20 minutes long. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And I'll dig that out. I should play some of that on the show. It's unbelievably good. Yep. Duran Duran ruled. See, I didn't know if I was going to go with Judas Priest tonight with Twitter, or if I was going Duran Duran. And Priest is too easy. We talk about Priest all the time. Too easy. KK, too easy. Like, what is KK's worst guitar solo? all of them. Follow us on Twitter at J Church Radio, Facebook, YouTube. Everything is Jimmy Church Radio, Fade to Black, all that stuff. Follow, like, subscribe. Tonight, Linda Godfrey, Monsters and Demons. Tomorrow night, Father Ashcraft, Exorcism. Wednesday, Ouija Night with Tracy Twyman. And then Thursday night, Fader Night, Shah will be here all night, Fader Night, taking your calls. Halloween week kicks off tonight. How is everybody doing? I'm fired up. Let's go. This is Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, you have tuned into the latest phenomenon in late night talk radio, Fade to Black, starring the inimitable Jimmy Church, showcasing his continuing quest in pursuit of knowledge of the strange paranormal. Sit back, open your mind, and let's get cracking.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National Tax Experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444, or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Walking, talking, chewing gum. Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Welcome, everybody, listening all around the world. It is Halloween week. Okay, I just tweeted a video. I did it earlier tonight. I just tweeted it again. Got an email from Tony. He says, I live in Fort Collins, Colorado, and I've been listening to your show since the beginning. I saw this clip on YouTube the other night and became extremely interested in the story, but haven't been able to find any updates since it first aired on Channel 9 News in early October. I'm hoping you might look into this and see if you can find out any information. I thought it was especially interesting how no one in law enforcement wanted to speak on camera. Now, I just posted the video. It is pretty strange. I've watched it a couple of times. Pretty interesting how you have the news reporter on scene, too, witnessing this. And apparently they were seen up in Utah, too, as well. So anybody in that area, I think it's Breckenridge. Is that where it's at? Anybody in that area see it? Is there any updates? I'd like to know. I'd like to get back to Tony. Tony's probably listening right now, too, as well. So light up Twitter here. There you go. See, email from Roger. Today in a local paper, I read a big article in the headline section. It was about the official ending of the Afghanistan war, and General Fallon said that this day would go down in history. Strange thing, it was on the very last page of the front section of the newspaper, and I didn't see it mentioned on the internet. Isn't this really big news? So what gives? Is there something screwy going on in the news today? I did hear it. Well, by the way, I'm 1 week of CNN free. 1 week, no CNN. So what I've been doing is not going to CNN.com as well. This is my little thing. So, you know, just want to see if the news in my little universe feels different. So I don't know if CNN's been covering this. I did see today, though, on Al Jazeera. They did a story on it. And about the last Marines pulling out today and handing over that base to the Afghan army. Now, I don't know if that means that there's no army left. I know the Marines have pulled out. I can't imagine. I don't know. I don't know. But I do agree with what Roger said in the email. It's kind of strangely silent in the news cycle. I don't know what CNN, like I said, I'm weaning off of CNN. I'm starting to go to some other news sources. Al Jazeera. Ah! But yes, I did. This email came in from JP. And this was, we were talking last week about Kurt Cobain's T-shirt and the cartoon character that was on it. And it was a character drawn by Daniel Johnston. Has anybody seen the documentary with Daniel Johnston about, well, I guess ultimately it's about his relationship with Kurt Cobain. But it was the downward spiral of Daniel Johnston. And if you haven't seen that documentary, I watched it when it was on, when it was making the I'm going to say 2008, maybe 2007. It was on cable pretty, you know, it seemed like it had a couple month run. And I watched it. I don't even know now. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times. Amazing documentary. And if you haven't seen it, go check it out. It's Daniel Johnston with a T. Check it out. Somebody on Twitter pop up that video, that documentary. I think it's called The Devil and Daniel Johnston. Is that right? Could be wrong. He says, JP says in the email that the image said, "Hi, how are you?" And it used to be painted on the outside of a wall in the old Tower Records in Austin, Texas. That's where Daniel Johnston was from. And great documentary. Thank you, JP, for that email and reminding us of that. I think it's The Devil and Daniel Johnston. All right. There was a story going around on the internet the last couple of days. Another one of those stories. I got a couple of them here. NASA, this was the headline. NASA confirms Earth will experience 6 days of total darkness in December. I thought, wow, it's kind of crazy. And again, another one of those hoax stories. Recent report citing NASA claimed that there will be 6 days of total darkness in December. The report, however, turned out to be a hoax. The story, titled NASA Confirms Earth Will Experience 6 Days of Total Darkness in December 2014, originated on the satirical news website Hustlers.com, which in the past has published several fake stories, such as dead Ebola victims coming back to life and American rapper Tupac is alive. The fake report that was shared by many Facebook and Twitter stated, NASA has confirmed that the Earth will experience 6 days of almost complete darkness and will remain from the dates Tuesday, the 16th, Monday, to the 22nd of December. Just bugs me. Why? Just for clicks, you know, for money, to stir the pot like that. For myself and for you, the listeners of this show, the fans, the fader nots, You see something like that and you click immediately. I did. Ugh. Here's another one. Now, this story was posted by different friends and listeners on Facebook. Went all over Twitter. Okay? It was all over the place. About the massive truck convoy. Thank you for posting that, Robert. I'm going to watch that tonight. I haven't watched that in a while. The Devil and Daniel Johnston. That's going to get a retweet. Let's go. Bam. Click. Done. Thank you, Robert. The truck convoy. And the live leak video, which I watched, and was pretty trippy to watch. Motorists baffled by massive convoy of semi-trucks guided by state troopers. I thought, okay, all right. Of course, now it's Ebola vaccines. It's, you know, all these crazy reports. Large convoy of trucks along the interstate in Virginia over the weekend drew some attention, but not many knew that they were what they were out there doing. In a thread on social news sites like Reddit, someone dubbed the live leak video of the scene as very strange convoy of trucks. That's what I saw. And I'm quoting here, on the interstate, numerous state troopers followed by a line of everything is blocked off, followed by a line of duplicate convoy freight trains. The woman filming said later, noticing that other drivers were filming the strange sight as well. After the convoy trucks came a line of Coca-Cola trucks, followed by Walmart. Turns out, it was all done to be the world's largest truck convoy to raise money for the Special Olympics. 124 trucks were involved. Last year, they had 49 trucks. They raised 20 grand for the Special Olympics. This year, $124. I hope they raise more money. But it just goes to show you, you know, live leak. Live leak. Over in Hawaii, the lava flows are speeding up. Have you been watching these reports out of Hawaii? A little bit nutty, isn't it? Lava flowing towards the village of Pahoa from Hawaii's Kilauea volcano picked up speed over the weekend, prompting emergency officials to close part of the main road through town and tell residents to be prepared to evacuate. Lava was about 100 yards from the closest home. I think it destroyed a cemetery. It's flowing right now at about 10. Check this out. 10 to 15 yards per hour. It's going to reach the first house by tonight. Unbelievable. I've been watching this video, and I got to tell you, if I owned a house in that area and I'm looking out the window seeing that, it's pretty crazy. And it is erupting. Kilauea is erupting right now. Pretty crazy. I'm excited. Tonight, Linda Godfrey. The kickoff of Halloween week. If you do have a story you want me to cover, you want us to check out, you want us to get into deep, email me, jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. You can do it through the website. Just let us know. We can't find out everything. That's why you are there. This is Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church. This is Halloween week. Tonight, Linda Godfrey. Tomorrow night, Father Ashcraft. Wednesday, Tracy Twyman. Thursday, Shaw. We'll be taking your calls all night on Fader Night. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Are you afraid of the dark? Don't move. Don't touch that mouse. You are listening to Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter. Dark Matter. Dark Matter.
You're listening to Fade to Black
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Yeah. You know what that means. It means let's get this show cracking. This is Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church, and I am ready. Wow. You know, for the first guest for a Halloween week, this is what you want to do. 14 investigator and former newspaper journalist Linda S. Godfrey is the author of 16 books on strange creatures, people, and places, including The Beast of Bray Road, Weird Wisconsin, Weird Michigan, The Real Wolfman, True Encounters of Modern America, and her most recent, American Monsters, A History of Monster Lore, Legends, and Sightings in America. She has been a guest on national TV and radio shows, including 30-odd Minutes, Monster Quest, Sean Hannity's America, Lost Tapes, Inside Edition, Sci-Fi's Haunted Highway, Monsters and Mysteries, Wisconsin and Michigan Public Radio, Coast to Coast AM, and many more. She illustrates many of her own books and lives in southeast Wisconsin on the edge of the Kettle Moraine State Forest. I would like to welcome to the program Linda Godfrey. How are you tonight, Linda?
Hello, I'm great, thanks. And how about you?
Oh, I'm scared.
Well, you should be.
I'm scared. Welcome to the program. I'm fired up. I haven't seen this much excitement from our audience in quite a long time. You've got quite the following out there, young lady. Yeah. Are you aware of how many fans you actually have?
I don't know. I've never had a count.
That's not the right answer. You're supposed to say, you know what? Yeah, I got a grip. I got millions out there.
Well, I don't know if they're millions, but they're great. You know, that much I know.
Can I say one thing?
Sure.
You don't fit the mold. In other words, you know, when this is what you remind me of. You know, I'm in fifth grade hanging out with my friends, and we're going home after school, and I hit my friend Keith's house, you know, to go in and hang out. And you're like Keith's mom.
Well, I am some people's mom, so I guess that makes sense.
You know, and you know where I'm going with this, you know?
I'm not sure.
Right on, Linda. I mean, you know, hey, Keith, what does your mom do? Hey, man, she writes books on monsters. Really? No way. Really? You know, and I think it's great. And, you know, you live where, you and I were talking about this, you know, where I grew up. And that part of the country, Wisconsin, Northern Illinois, you know, Minnesota, that part of, there are some great monster legends and myths. And I think some of the best stories originate there, and sightings originate there. And I remember as a kid, and I would like to start off here. I remember going camping many, many times in Wisconsin with the family. We would go up to the Blue Mounds. We would go up to different lakes. Of course, Lake Geneva is a great spot, too, as well.
Oh, yeah.
And I know you're not too far from there. No. But there was always crazy campfire stories that were going around about what was in the woods and the forest up there, which, unless you've been there, really, you have, like, Green Bay and Milwaukee, and then forest.
Forest and lakes.
Yeah, forest and lakes. And
it's not fields of cows. That's the image people have of Wisconsin.
Yeah, dairy.
We have those, but that's far from all there is.
Totally. So why do you think, let's start with that. Why do you think there is such a prevalence of really good campfire stories up there? Do they originate from somewhere?
Well, I think that Wisconsin is a good microcosm to discuss this in, because it's one that has, I think I read somewhere that Wisconsin has the greatest variety of different types of settlers that have come here. And even up into modern times, at first it was European settlers, and then we've had from all over the place. I won't name names, but we also have a really rich tradition of lots and lots of different native peoples who are already here. And you put all of those together, you have the settlers bringing what they remember from old Europe, and you have the Native American tales, and then you've got this incredible landscape with not just forests, but we've got rivers with cliffs, and we've had places where the glacier came through, places where the glacier stopped, and the Great Lakes, on two sides. So you put all this together and you're just going to get stories.
Can you back off your microphone just a little bit?
Sure.
Getting a little wind stuff, pop, 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 pop. That's all.
Okay.
That's all. It's good. You're perfect.
Okay.
I look back at my childhood, and when I think about some of the sightings up there with that was the first time I heard about Bigfoot, was something was sighted up in Wisconsin. I remember that as a kid. And hearing about werewolves, I used to hear about that. I remember hearing these stories, not so much in North Chicago, Waukegan. It was always when you crossed the state line.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah, and we also have a lot of sightings right on the state line for some strange reason.
Why do you think that is?
I do not know.
and I'm trying to paint this picture for everybody. You have to understand, it is thick woods, and forests going on for miles, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles. And if you're going to hide out, that's a good place for a monster to hide out.
Mm-hmm. Well, the state line is also, with Illinois, is also fairly close to the Kettle Moraine State Park, which right from the very beginning, back in 1992, kind of popped out at me as a likely place where a lot of these things could hang out, because this state forest is not just ground and trees. It's the place where the last glacier stopped. And when it stopped, all these lobes of ice carved out hundreds and hundreds of deep kettle-shaped depressions with ridges in between. And the kettles were shaped like those old-fashioned pots that you'd hang over a campfire.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they're called kettles. And then the ridges are called the moraines. Now, down in those kettles, all kinds of overgrowth and weird plants grow. Most people don't go down there because they're quite treacherous in many places with those steep sides. There's just very loose soil with rock underneath, so it's easy to slip down. I've slid down more than one on the seat of my jeans, I'll tell you that. And this is where, on one side of them, we have a predominance of dogman sightings. On the other side of the Kettle Moraine, I get more Bigfoot sightings. It's kind of like they've divided it up. And then we have other things coming out there. We have large birds, we have goat man, we have just about any strange thing that you could think of. Lake monsters, they're all there.
When I was talking to you earlier today, you said you were out. Tell everybody what you were doing today. It stopped me in my tracks.
Oh, well, I was out actually climbing a slope up the side of one of these kettles. I live outside the state forest, but I have certain places where I feel kind of safe, where I know the people who own it, it's private property, or there are certain trails where I can go. And there's a place that's had some recent activity, and I needed to go and look for footprints. And so I had my cell phone turned off. I think that was why this came up. So in case anybody called me. If anything was around, I wouldn't scare it away. But I was also putting out some bait and things like that for future reference. So, yeah, I have muscles hurting where I didn't know I had muscles. That was a pretty steep slope, actually.
And were you missing any bait?
The bait I was missing, I'm pretty sure squirrels got, unfortunately. I thought I had a squirrel-proof little dealy set up, but it turned out not to have worked. That's the really hard thing about baiting any of these creatures. You just don't know what else is going to come and get it. And it's really hard to construct something that something else can't get in. You know, there are just so many really talented animals around here. The deer are really good at it. And, you know, squirrels can get just about anything. So that's always the tricky part. But, you know, I was rewarded. I did find some places where it looked like very deep prints of fingers had gone in trying to scale their way up that slope. Fairly recently. So,
what did they look like?
They just looked like fingers that were probably about three times the width of mine or more. That had just where you could just kind of see there was a big set of them that had sort of dug in order to get a hold to, you know, pull themselves up.
Right.
So I can't prove it. You know, it's hard to say, but partly because of the type of soil, but They looked a lot like it, and it was kind of what I was expecting to see because it was almost vertical right at that one spot, and there's no place for a regular footprint to go.
What kind of sightings do you have out there? Have you had one yourself?
I've had an encounter, and I've seen like parts of what I really believe were Bigfoot, and I've had an encounter where one ripped a giant living branch off an oak tree right in front of my face. I've narrowed it down. There's absolutely nothing else I could come up with that could have done it. Plus, my friend half an hour later saw the Bigfoot right there within, you know, probably 100 yards of where that encounter took place.
What do you mean? I have to stop you right there. What do you mean It ripped a branch off right in front of you? What did you see?
Yeah, what I saw was this huge old oak tree that was growing up out of a kennel, and I was on one of these spots where I know the people have permission to kind of walk down in there, and I was just taking a regular walk. In fact, it was a spur of the minute thing. I had not brought a camera, of course, or even my cell phone. I had nothing with me, and I just, for some reason, I had never done this. This was 2 years ago in the summer. I decided I would just bang on this tree because I had seen a formation that I knew was supposed to mean Bigfoot living there, and I'd never seen that on that particular walk before. So I thought, oh, what the heck, nobody's around, it's Sunday evening, everybody who lives anywhere near here is gone. So I hit the tree a few times, and lo and behold, I started getting some knocks back from down in the kennel. And I know this kennel well enough to know people don't go down there. It's just full of brambles down in the bottom, and it's one of those that's kind of hard to get down into. So I knew it was something with an opposable thumb that was able to hold a stick of some kind to make a noise, and then I could see big rustlings going on. I could see big, you know, there was very, very heavy foliage. I have to mention that. It was like July, very wet sort of humid weather, so everything was green and lush. And I was starting to get scared, but I remember thinking, well, I'm close enough, I could run back up to the trail if I need to before it could get up out of that kennel, I hope, because I wanted to see what it was. And then the next thing I know, I banged the tree one more time, and this huge oak tree that was just across the kennel from me, something just behind the foliage tore this 35-foot-long, 9-inch diameter at the base, living branch off of the tree from about 40 feet up off the ground, which was the bottom of the kennel. And I'm staring dumbfounded. And in that first movement, it twisted the branch so that it was coming horizontally around 90 degrees until it pointed right at me, which I felt was very personal. And then in the second movement, it ripped the branch off the rest of the way. And these were two sharp cracks. Like if you hear in the winter when the trees are covered with ice and, you know, the branches are falling, that's how loud these things were. The second one dropped it 40 feet down to the bottom of that kettle floor. And that's when I knew this just couldn't have been a person. And so I ran and got some friends. We actually went back down there within half an hour. And very brave friends, I have to say, my friend Sandra and her daughter Natalie. And we got down there, and I looked to make sure there were no woodpecker holes rotting it or no saw marks for some reason on the branch. And nothing was there. It was fresh, twisted, clean wood, evidently just taken off. We found hand rub prints where something, a hand that was like 9 inches long at least, had crumpled the bark where it was gripping that branch so hard to try it to, and it's just exactly what you would have to do if you're going to twist it enough to get enough torque to rip it all the way off. And I still have one of those pieces, and it smelled, the whole place down there smelled the classic, what they always say Bigfoot smells like, the skunkish, not like, not a skunk, but kind of like a skunk with the grassy odor and everything. And at that point, we got kind of nervous. We walked back up out of the kettle. My friend's daughter happened to look one way. We looked another way, Sandra and I. And then Natalie screamed because she saw the creature. And she said it was bigger than a human. She saw it taking long strides just as it disappeared into another bank of foliage. And it was, she described it as a light beige and light gray mixed, which some people call the blonde Bigfoot. And she didn't even know there was such a thing. She thought they were all dark brown. And she furthermore didn't know that I've had other sightings of this exact same color description within miles. I mean, really not very far away at all. Several of them. So that did it, and we left. I've since found 16, 17-inch footprints down there, usually on the vertical walls, so I can't cast them because the plaster all runs straight down. But I have photos. And I've had, you know, other small incidents. But that was one night I did not go to sleep that night.
So I'm not going to make light of this, but three women, you know, you guys are crazy. You guys are nuts. And you're pounding on the trees, right? You're knocking on the trees.
I was in the beginning.
Yeah, right. So you're
brought them back.
Linda, you're just asking for trouble.
Yeah, I probably was because, you know, and I've always made this point myself, which is that we don't know for sure what tree knocks mean. We think they may use it as a warning. We think it may be some form of long-distance communication, but we don't know for sure what the exact message one Bigfoot gets from another, you know, when they're knocking trees at each other.
Well, not only that, but you don't know what message you're sending either.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
Come on, big boy. Well, what are you going to do?
I'll tell you, whatever it was, I had the feeling that it was getting angrier and angrier. You know, I think that it had, it was just getting on towards evening, and that tree was right on the edge of a very well-used deer trail. And I think that it was probably kind of hiding out looking to, you know, wait for a deer to come through when they started having their evening movement toward where they're going to lie down for the night. And I interrupted his dinner.
Yes, you did.
Or her dinner. I don't know.
Right. Probably worse. Just back here. Do you have a headset on?
I do.
Yeah. Just pull the microphone away from your mouth a little bit or down below your lip, you know, towards your chin.
I'll put it even lower. Sorry.
No. You sound like you're right here, but we're just, you know, I get that occasional wind pop.
Tell me if it keeps up.
Okay.
Well, I've moved it now quite a bit.
Now you sound fine. So don't trip. It's all good. But yeah, don't you ever wonder? I mean, because whenever I see guys, and somebody just tweeted, what do you think about the TV show Mountain Monsters? Whenever I see those shows and I see those guys knocking on the tree, isn't that, to me, that's not very smart. You know, you don't know the friendly knock is what I'm saying. The hello knock. What are you doing tonight knock? You don't know. And obviously you're not afraid, but couldn't there be some consequences? And you were, it sounds like you were close to something this time.
Yeah, definitely. I feel that it probably was not my smartest moment, but I was sort of caught up in the moment. You know, I was just shocked when I got a return. I was just on a pure lark. Like I said, I had never actually done that before. I always sort of thought it wasn't the best thing to do. And yet I thought, well, you know, here's something that really looks like a structure that they're supposed to make. It was three saplings that were bent over together in a rainbow arch for no obvious reason and somehow kind of lashed together. And so I thought, well, just for fun, nobody's around here. I'm just going to try and knock. And, you know, if I hadn't gotten those knocks back, I would have just gone on my merry way and that would have been the end of it. But once something answers you, it's really hard to leave that, you know, just leave it alone. So, and like I said, I thought that I probably could get back out of the way fast enough if I needed to, which may have been very wrong too, because I'm sure these creatures can move incredibly fast. They're used to this kind of terrain and built for it, and they seem to prefer very sloped terrains around different parts of the United States. So, I mean, and I was on its home turf.
I've got so many questions that are rolling by here on Twitter, so let me scroll back. One of them, okay, ask Linda if she knows about or has an update on the possession demon story in Gary, Indiana.
They may have to, let's see, the possession demon story in Gary, Indiana. I'm not, that one just isn't ringing a bell right off the top of my head. So if they can give me a little bit more on that. I'm sorry, I'm just not sure which one you're referencing.
That's fine. There's a bunch right in a row here. Can you ask Linda what she thinks about Lloyd Pye's research on Bigfoot?
You know, I don't comment on other researchers' research because, for one thing, I think that I really believe that we live in a big tent universe and that there's room for everybody's campers of all different types in it, and that when you've got a great diversity of types of research, that you can put it together and see things that you would never have found otherwise. And also, you know, different people work in different ways, and sometimes your remarks can be misinterpreted, but I'm generally in favor of most all other types, except I really don't agree with killing the Bigfoot.
Right, yeah. I always freaks me out when I see those guys armed, you know, going in searching for, I mean, what do you plan on, you know, if worse comes to worse, that's what you're going to do is kill them?
I just don't get it, because it's, anybody who's a hunter knows the number one axiom is, unless you're in imminent danger of being killed yourself, if you don't know what something is and you're not sure that it's something you've got a license to kill, or that you have the right to kill, or you need to kill it, why are you killing it? If it's unknown, why would you take a chance? You know, and these things officially, although many people have seen them up close, many people feel they know what they are, officially they're still regarded as unknown animals. So I just don't understand how someone can feel they can do that, even if they believe it's for the Bigfoot species own good, to get identified. That's the rationale, that it will be identified and then perhaps protected.
Right. Your sightings, have you been outside of Wisconsin? Have you been up to, you know, Seattle, Tacoma, the Pacific Northwest?
I haven't had the good fortune of being able to travel that far. I've been to Salt Fork State Park, you know, a few other places, but that's kind of on my bucket list to get out to those West Coast states.
Do you think it's the same species?
I think that there may be different subspecies. The ones on the West Coast seem a lot bigger, and the Native American tales vary. The Native American tales about them on the West Coast seem to talk about much more aggressive creatures and much larger creatures they get smaller when they go eastward, you know, and that's been kind of observed for a very long time as they head toward the East Coast. But I think that just as there are, you know, different cultures of people, maybe there are different cultures of these creatures. And it's hard to say exactly whether they're human-like, or some people think that they actually are. I personally don't think that from everybody's description, and I've had some people give me some really close-up good descriptions, I don't think they are exactly human, but I think they could be very close, and I think they you can be people without being human, if you know what I'm saying.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
they can
yes,
be
yes.
sentient. They can be sentient beings and be very like us.
Clyde Lewis, I don't know if you've heard this story from Clyde, but last month he was on the show with us, and I was talking to him off the air, and he tells me this story. He said, you know, we were up filming a documentary on the Maury Island UFO case, and we had a cabin, a couple of cabins next to the woods, you know, up there in the Tacoma area, and they were done with the documentary that morning. As they were getting ready to leave and go back to Portland, they're drinking coffee, and off there was a door that was on the side of the cabin for the kitchen, okay? Not the front porch, but to the side. And they were sitting there, and then a baby Bigfoot ran by the window, ran by the door. And he said he jumped up and yelled, "There's Bigfoot!" And he described kind of like what you're... friend's daughter described light fur, right? Mm-hmm. Of course, mm-hmm. naked fur, head to toe. But he said he described it as Michael J. Fox and Teen Wolf.
And my goodness.
In other words, no hair on the face, right? Long hair, and you know, fur head to toe, but it was a baby Bigfoot and ran by, and then they all jumped up, ran out the door, and it ran into the woods. And, of course, they ran into the woods, too, and lost it. But he saw it, and this was last month. Did you hear him talk about this?
I didn't, but that's a great story. I love it.
And, of course, my first thing with Clyde was, okay, man, did you get a picture? You got a film crew up there. Nope, didn't get a picture.
The film crew is never facing the right way.
You know, he's up there filming a documentary of all things, mm-hmm. and this ran by, and it happened so quick. He said, it was running really fast. And then I think he said it was screaming once it got into the woods. Yeah, mm-hmm. But he described it as, I believe he said it was, you know, like Michael J. Fox and Teen Wolf. So I'm picturing the tan fur, you know, not black, you know.
Right.
Am I describing it correctly? Yeah, kind of a tan, but a very interesting sighting for him, and he is right there now, full on believer. Like, they were up there shooting a UFO documentary. That was the last thing that they expected to see, was this go running by and then into the woods by itself.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's really cool. I've had baby Bigfoot reported to me. There was one woman who lives, again, near the Kettle Moraine, not in it, but nearby it. And they have a farm, and sometimes there are poultry carcasses that are thrown out, you know, in the back lot line. And they have seen small groups of Bigfoot come up to the lot line. And one time she said there was a female Bigfoot carrying a baby or a small child, and she watched it set it down in the snow and then pick up whatever it wanted from the pile that was there, and then pick the baby up again and walk off. And it left a little Bigfoot baby butt print in the snow.
No way.
Of course, they didn't get pictures. They want to remain anonymous, or if they had them, they wouldn't share. But yeah, and it's a very credible person too. It's somebody that I know who it is, and I know they wouldn't make this up. And it makes sense because there have been other sightings very, very close to there.
We've just posted your gallery. So if everybody wants to go over to JimmyChurchRadio.com, just scroll down right there. is Linda's Gallery. I'm opening it up for the first time. Now, what we did is these are posted in order, okay? So in the order that you sent them to us. And I'm looking at the first picture, which is Monster Bigfoot number one. By the way, these are all your own illustrations, right?
Right, except I think there's one witness sketch near the end.
Okay. And I bet you that is... Monster Dragon. Oh, that one's cool. Right. Okay, let's not get ahead of ourselves. That's pretty creepy. Mm-hmm. Okay, Monster Bigfoot number one. And we're going to take a break right here. Or I'm going to do a station ID. We're not going to take a break. This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. We are talking with Linda Godfrey. This is the kickoff, day one of Halloween week. And really honored, Linda, to have you with us tonight, by the way. It's a great kickoff to the week, and thank you for everything. So let's go to the first picture. I want to – somebody just texted me, black-eyed children. Then I got another text about Goat Man. I've got another text about the Beast of Bray Road. So we've got our work cut out for us this evening. Let's start with this first one, Monster Bigfoot. What are we looking at here?
Well, that's my own interpretation of Bigfoot, as he's very often seen running across the road by people, often from one cornfield into another. Very similar in that way to the Dog Man. A lot of people just, especially around here, seem to encounter him that way. And I was just trying to show the general features, the way most people describe him, and and make it sort of an artistically interesting picture. So,
are they smarter than us?
I would have no idea, but I think that they are probably more intelligent than people give them credit for.
Right.
And that they, I'm quite sure, have sensory equipment that we don't have. I'm sure they have anything that lives in the wild like that is going to have much better sense of smell. They probably have different vision attributes than we do. And who knows what other things they've developed. Many, many people swear that they receive sort of subliminal messages from them, not like telepathy or anything too ooky spooky. Sometimes I think it's just from reading the body language. But they seem to be able to communicate somehow when they want to. And that takes something that's very intelligent.
Well, I look at two or three things when it comes to Bigfoot and Sasquatch that impresses me. One, they seem to be able to avoid getting hit by cars.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And like you said, here's one running across the street, but we haven't hit one. And so that shows intelligence. Two, they really have avoided human contact. So they know how to do that. You know, there's a lot of evidence out there for Bigfoot, a lot of sightings, of course, the Patterson film, which I'm a huge fan of. And I think that film is 100% authentic. I don't question that at all. But we haven't, none have been hit by a car. We haven't had any real human interaction, you know, like a sit-down interview, if you know what I mean. So they avoid us. And three, we haven't found a body. And so obviously they're burying their dead. And we don't find, there's one thing that needs to be driven home. We don't find chimpanzee bodies in the jungle either. You know, we don't find ape carcasses. They're just not there. And this is the same thing. I've always questioned that whenever I've had somebody on, you know, Jeffrey Meldrum or, you know, yourself. Why haven't we found a body? Well, we don't find chimpanzee bodies either. And so they're smarter than we give them credit for, is what I'm trying to say.
Usually you don't find any apex predator body in any of the kinds of numbers that you find the bodies of prey animals, partly because there are many fewer of them. There are many fewer per acre because they have territories. And also they have many fewer things to die from. And when they do die, there are all kinds of opportunistic animals that will come and get rid of whatever evidence is there. And that can happen really quickly. I've seen like a 180-pound deer gone in 24 hours.
Right.
From, you know, another situation that I've been working on where we're setting out deer. I think we're on number 10 over a year's time. And various things happen to these deer. But it's sort of interesting with that situation between the Bigfoot and the Dogman, because I always say, if you did find a dead Bigfoot, you'd know what you had. You know, there's just no mistaking something that's 8 feet tall, covered with fur, you know, very human-like. And, well, and the corollary to that is there, it may have been found and we're just not privy to that knowledge. You know, I'm not a real conspiracy theorist, but I have noticed in my 22 years of dealing with this sort of thing that the authorities are not generally really forthcoming when there's this sort of incident going on. And I'm really not sure that if a body was found that we would all be told about it, you know, it might be hidden somehow. But if you found a dead dog man, to finish my original thought, you might just say, well, there's a really big, dead, weird-looking wolf-dog type of thing, because they're not human-like at all. They're canine, except that what makes them seem and feel human is that they're walking on their hind legs. But that's something any mammal can do, just about any mammal, if it's trained or motivated to do that. It's not really a supernatural thing. And their skeletons are still like canines. They have ears. They have pointed ears on top of their heads. They have fangs. They have paws. You know, so it's a very different case history. But yeah, that is the number one skeptic's question, and I don't blame them for asking it. You know, it's reasonable to ask where the bodies are.
You've referenced now Dogman a half a dozen times. Tell us who the Dogman is.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, that's okay. I want to know.
Pull that in there. Well, the Dogman, as far as I can tell, is something that is quite different other than being sort of an apex predator type. It's canine. It's not humanoid in any way, really. It is not primate. It walks on toe pads like any canine. It has fangs along a muzzle, usually long, but once in a while, people will describe a somewhat shorter snout, like a boxer, they might say, a boxer dog, but to add that it still was totally canine. It has paws with claws instead of hands, like the Bigfoot has. It's not nearly as bulky or big. Usually they're reported at between 5 and 7 feet tall, but weighing much less than a Bigfoot that size would weigh.
Ooh.
The footprints are completely different, and they actually seem much more aggressive and will often chase people and snarl at them, and just kind of a lot scarier. If I had to meet one or the other, I think I'd much prefer to meet the Bigfoot in the woods than the Dogman. But the Dogman is what initially got me started along this path 21, 22 years ago, and I still receive reports just usually 1 to 3 a week 22 years later.
Where are they mostly sighted?
All over the country. That's the other thing. People think, well, the Dogman was just this beast of Bray Road that was on this little road in Wisconsin. And actually, that's very far from the truth. The Beast of Bray Road just is the title of the first reported group of sightings of upright dog-like creatures. And I like to use that term, upright unknown canines or upright dog-like or wolf-like creatures, because I don't really believe that these things are werewolves. I say in many of my books, I don't believe in the old traditional man changing all of his body and flesh into the form of a wolf, you know, and then changing bodily back, just like on the old Lon Chaney or Jack Nicholson movies. That's not what I think these things are. Nobody's ever seen one in the process of
changing
like that. Although there have been a couple of strange morphing cases, but only a very small, not even a full handful after 22 years. That's sort of an just a separate category. But most of the sightings I get, well into the 90th percentile, I would say, don't really have the creature doing anything that's supernatural. It's running or walking on its hind legs. It does have eye shine, but it's yellow or yellow-green eye shine, which is the typical one for canines. Sometimes people get the idea that these upright dog men have an attitude that it shouldn't have. They'll say it sneered at me or it jeered at me, or I felt that it wanted me to know that it could come and get me. It could jump in my car. It could, you know, find me, that kind of thing. So there are some odd things about it, but part of that might just be from the shock of seeing this dog or wolf-like creature chasing you on its hind legs. That would have to have some effect.
Europe, we have the classic wolfman, right, that we were just talking about. Mm-hmm. And here the dogman is, you don't think the two, you think they're two, they're singular. We don't have a relation to the wolfman. That's another monster exclusive to Europe.
I think that they're all different terms in this country, or at least in North America, for the same creature. And I've had the same thing actually reported in different countries in Europe, too. Wolfman, dogman, whatever you want to call it. It's not the same thing as that old idea that there's a creature actually changing from one type to the other. And that's that old tradition that comes out of Europe. But you have this idea of shape-shifting animals in societies all around the world. And it's usually involving whatever animal is the apex predator. You know, it's
right.
It could be a were-lion or in some...
A were-lion?
A were-lion, sure, in Africa, yep. Were-jaguars in Japan, they've got the kitsune or the were-fox. So it's a really universal idea, but it does not sound like what these creatures are. For one thing, in all the reports, hundreds of reports I've gotten over the 22 years, these don't attack people. You know, if you go back to France and the very famous legend of the Beast of Gévaudan, where there were either one or two of these great wolf-like beasts actually killed a lot of people and a lot of livestock. And there definitely was something making depredations on the countryside. We don't have that with these creatures. I've got lots of great witnesses, very credible, sober witnesses. We've got footprints. We've got things like that. But we don't have any evidence that it's even seriously injured a person. Pets and small livestock are a little different. There have been people have seen it go after their chickens. Two ladies in northern Illinois heard a big ruckus on their patio one night and went and looked out and saw this upright 6-foot-tall dog man standing there with their cat in its mouth. And they were able to pound on the – they did go out, but they pounded on the door and yelled and kind of – and turned on the outdoor light, which shocked it enough that it dropped the cat. But I have another report of a person who claims they saw one of these creatures actually kill their dog, you know, right in front of their eyes. So
– what about skinwalkers, then, the relationship to that? I had a we did a remote broadcast from Skinwalker Ranch and with Steve Murillo, who called in, and he brought on a witness up there, and he came on the show with us, and he said what they see up there, amongst other things, but was this black dog with large with red eyes, but mm-hmm. but no legs, or you couldn't see it walk. You think there's a relationship between Dogman and that? And those sightings have been going on with the Indians for, you know, hundreds of years.
Right. Right. Yeah, I think that it's a different phenomenon. I really do. Because there are several differences. A lot of these type of sightings are centered around reservation areas, as the Skinwalker Ranch was, I believe, either part of or right along next to a Ute reservation. They often have the red eye shine, which is not normal for canines. They seem to be bigger. They are almost always a jet black.
Mm-hmm.
They have phantom characteristics, such as like you described, fading in and out. People will see them staring at their windows. There's one really horrifying story like that in the canine chapter in American Monsters of a woman living on a reservation. I'm thinking it's Oklahoma. I don't have it right in front of me, so I may be wrong on that. But she saw it come up to her window, stare in the window to where its nose was making a print on the glass, and put its hands, and in this case, it had hands, not the paws that people see on the normal regular dogmen that are, you know, running around the countryside. It was the jet black, and then when she went outside and looked the next day, she realized it had to have been at least 8 feet tall to have been looking in from where it was. You know, there was nothing to stand on or anything there. So these things seem like they're quite different in characteristics and probably origin than the more normal-looking, upright dog and wolf-like creatures. And, you know, there are a lot of Native traditions connected with this type. Many of the people that I've talked to are kind of afraid of them. It's something that is a little outside the box in terms of their normal traditions. And it's nothing that I really pursue personally. You know, it's the kind of thing I just see as a separate sort of category to comment on. But, you know, there's just some places I don't like to go personally, and that's one of them.
Tell us about the Beast of Bray Road before we get off the subject. Let's just go right there.
The Beast of Bray Road was the name that I came up with because even right away back in it was New Year's Eve of 1991, so we went right into 1992. I did not like the term werewolf. I did not think that this is what we were dealing with. And what happened was I had just started working for this newspaper in Walworth County called The Week, and people started saying around my own hometown that they were seeing what they described as a werewolf. And they were not only saying this, and I knew who some of them were, and I thought they were reasonable, credible people, they were calling the county animal control officer and saying, I saw this thing, and I don't know what it was, but if there was such a thing as a werewolf, this would be it. It was between 5 and 7 feet tall, had hair all over its body, had a long snout, ears on top of the head, just as I described earlier. And the official was actually keeping his manila file folder marked werewolf full of these contacts of people, and I started contacting him. And when I began talking to them, I decided they didn't seem like they were crazy or hoaxing. For one thing, if you're going to play a prank, and this was just my logic at the time, why would you leave all your contact information with the authorities, you know, to come and get you later when it was determined to be a prank? And many of these people didn't know each other. They didn't know the other ones existed. And we went ahead with the story because the county official had the file folder, so it was news. And within 2 weeks, it just went national and has never stopped in all that time. And it still is being seen occasionally. There was a real spate of sightings in the late 80s and early to mid 90s, and then it kind of slowed down. And every once in a while, I still hear about a sighting from somebody, and they aren't always right on Bray Road, but sometimes in that general area.
Anybody ever get a picture?
No. And there's a lot of reasons for that. I think one of them is that the sightings are normally random and fleeting. Nobody can predict when these things are going to show up. They don't come out necessarily on the full moon. They come out at different times of the day and night. There have been daylight sightings, although most of them are at night. And when something jumps out of the cornfield at you or runs across the road, even if you've got your cell phone handy, by the time you slow down, hold it up, you know, switch over to the camera mode, whatever it is long gone into the night, and especially if it's at night. And I've tested this out. There was a region just east of Lake Geneva where a very highly credible employee of an airport that I couldn't reveal his name or anything because he was afraid for his job had 4 different sightings of the wolf-like creature right in his neighborhood. And I went driving around that area one night at the times that he had seen it with a friend who had borrowed a police department nighttime camera, and she sat with it on at all times. And we did not see the creature, but we saw deer and a fox and a few other things right up fairly close to the car. They weren't moving very fast. We weren't able to get a decent image of any of them. And this person is pretty handy with a camera. So it's just the nature of so many of these either being seen when you're driving, or the same thing if you're hiking, you know, unless you've got the camera right up to your eye and you turn it and there's the creature in your viewfinder, you're probably not going to be able to get it. I have one incident in, I think it's in the new book, where a couple was hiking up in British Columbia, and they came across one of these dogmen almost face to face with it standing in the tree line, and the husband happened to be armed and was a little afraid of it. It looked like it might be aggressive and coming toward them, so he started to raise his rifle, and the thing just kind of didn't look like it was going to phase it. And then I think it was the wife was getting out her camera, and that the creature looked at and then ran off. So it was almost like it was more afraid of the camera than the gun. And when people do shoot them, by the way, both Bigfoot and the Dogman, there is a growing number of reports that show that they don't seem to be hurt by it that much. And it's almost like they've got Kevlar on under the fur, you know, and I'm not the only person to report that. That's, you know, I've seen that from other researchers too. So what's that about? I don't really know.
The last thing I would do is shoot.
Right.
The exactly. First thing I would do is run, because yeah. You better, I mean, that's the last thing you want to do is to make the dog man or a werewolf or anything like that angry.
Or Bigfoot. I mean,
yeah. Why would
and you? especially if they're not actually attacking you, you know. And there have been a few people in situations where they did feel that it was imminent. I had one guy who was fishing on a flat bottom boat in sort of a shallow river, and down in Alabama, and the creature started wading into the water toward him and his dog, and the dog jumped in and was swimming, and he was afraid it was going to take and kill his dog. So he emptied a couple of clips in it, and the thing just ran back into the woods, and as far as he knows, it just kept going.
And he drove away, if he was smart.
He rode away, and then as fast as he could go, you know, but maybe he had a motor on the boat, I don't remember. But yeah, he went the other direction.
This is from Ken. He says, please ask her about the Goatman sightings and if she's heard of the one in New Hampshire.
Well, I do know that there are several Goatmen in the eastern states, and I'm trying to think if it's New Hampshire. I've got several mentioned in my American Monsters. There's a real famous one in Wisconsin, and then I know Maryland has another very, very famous goat man. And I find that a lot of them seem to have similar legends to them. Either they were started by, either there was some sort of strange demon thing that got away, or somebody, I know with the Jersey Devil is a little bit different creature, but in that case, there was a woman who gave birth to a demon. And you find that sometimes with the Goatman one. New Hampshire's...
Are you saying, I've not heard that aspect of the Goatman. Are you saying the Goatman is directly connected to demons, one, and two, they're birthed from humans?
No. In some places there are legends like that, you know, and the goat man is found, what I'm saying is the goat man is found all over the country, and in some places it is considered linked to these demonic legend traditions. But, you know, I personally have my doubts as to really whether they're a separate creature or they look kind of like the old Greek and Roman idea of satyrs, which is the half goat, half man, you know, with the little hoofs. And I've had sometimes had people say, well, I saw a satyr in the woods. And then when I showed them my forensic sketch of the dogman, they'll say, that's what it was. It was that. You know, and it's just that they don't have any mindset for an upright dogman, but they do kind of, you know, and so many people have said when they see a creature, it's like their mind is going through a flip chart. No, it's not a bear. No, it's not that. No, it's not that. And when they come to something familiar and it seems to fit, they'll often settle on, okay, that's what it was. So I think sometimes goatman sightings might be mistaken sightings of dogman or even Bigfoot in some cases. But I do find that wherever they're found, you know, the one in Maryland had a legend about, I think there was this, in this case, it wasn't a demon, it was a scientist that somehow got bitten, or I'm grasping to remember exactly how that went, but he ended up being, you know, changing into this goat man and you know, running off to the woods. So you have these legends that you really don't have with any kind of ubiquitous all over the place legend with, say, the dog man or with the Bigfoot. They have their own peculiar place legends that are usually unique.
Right. Move your microphone back down to your chin. Right to the tip of your chin.
Okay, I'm getting it close to my neck. Pretty far down there. I'll see how far I can go. Yeah, it must be a very sensitive mic.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. It's slowly coming back. So with the goat man, is there one, before I want to jump into some more of these pictures, is there one that's, is Goatman evil? You know, it seems like Dogman hasn't killed any humans or any reports of that. What about the Goatman?
Well, in the legends, it seems to. For instance, the one in Wisconsin is in the northern Kettle Moraine State Forest. And that one is supposed to go back to Civil War times when a young newlywed couple was traveling in their covered wagon along this hill. And the wagon hit a rut and broke down. The husband got out and tried to walk. The wife heard his ghastly screams and peeped out and saw this goat man creature leaving the area. And the next day she finds the husband's body. And I've seen very similar legends, you know, in other states to that. And supposedly from that time on, the goat man haunted that region and was, in the modern age, he's supposed to try and tip automobiles over the steep roads rather than the covered wagons. So they kind of evolve with the times. But, you know, and I'm just looking at Maryland's Goatman of, so I would say that guy's evil. The Goatman of Prince George's County in Maryland, again, it's associated with a scientist at the Henry A. Wallace Beltsville Agricultural Research Center, north of Washington, D.C., and one of the genetic experiments that they were conducting was on goats, and one of these creatures bit him, transferring its saliva, and immediately he's kind of like getting bitten by a werewolf, except this time he grew horns, hooves, a tail, brown fur, and of course he went mad, and then he ran into the woods, and that's where he gets people and animals, and looks at teenagers in parked cars and that sort of thing, which is another thing that some of these creatures are said to do.
This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network, bespoke radio for the masses. I'm your humble host, Jimmy Church. We're kicking off Halloween week with Linda Godfrey, Monsters in America. And I, like I said, Linda, I just want to have a really good old-fashioned nightmare tonight. That's what I want. I want to have a good old-fashioned freaked-out nightmare.
I'll do my best.
The Jersey Devil. Now, before, the first time I heard about the Jersey Devil, way before the Blair Witch Project, there was a, it was like the original found footage film, and it was about, you know, these friends going into the woods there, looking for the Jersey Devil. That was the first time I heard about it, and I jumped on the internet, and sure enough, That is one of the oldest monsters in America. That's been around for a long, long time. So what's the what does the Jersey Devil look like?
Well, that's a good question, because many people have described it in different ways, and supposedly it goes back to 1735 in the area called the Pine Barrens, a seven-county stretch of dense trees and farms and cranberry bogs. And supposedly there was a woman who was found herself pregnant with the 13th child of the family. Her husband was gone or not providing. And so the woman allegedly cursed the child. It was born as some sort of a demon. It killed its whole family as a newborn and then ran into the woods where it would just attack livestock or unwary travelers after that. It was originally called the Phantom of the Pines. And then in 1909, some creature that people likened back to this 1735 thing started showing up around New Jersey in at least 30 different communities. And it went into Haddon Heights and showed itself to all the passengers on a city trolley. They said it looked like a kangaroo with wings. And then around the entire region, people started missing pets and farm animals. And they would find wherever this creature had been, they would see hoof prints on rooftops rather than, you know, things that look like they were made by dogs or normal types of prints.
Right, right.
So it was thought of as this mammal-type thing with bat-like wings, some kind of hooves, and yet a lot of whatever seemed like an odd animal in those times would get reported to be the Jersey Devil. So you ended up with a lot of other strange descriptions mixing in there, too. Some people said that it was deer-like, covered in dark, matted, shiny fur, with a deer-like head, glowing red eyes. They're usually something that's there. And supposedly there still actually are some sightings of them. Park Ranger John Irwin said he saw something like that in 1993. And one newspaper called them Hell Monkeys from Beyond. That's one of my favorite newspapers ever.
You hear the legend of the Jersey Devil. I mean, I think there was an episode of The Sopranos, you know, that you had it. Mm-hmm. I think that the people of New Jersey absolutely 100% believe in it. My question was, before I get to that question, how big is the Pine Barrens? It's actually quite large.
Yeah, it is. I think it stretches over seven counties in New Jersey. And it fills up it between Philadelphia and the Atlantic Ocean. I don't know exactly how many square miles that is, but seven counties, you can imagine that's a lot.
Here it is. In your recent blog, I was reading through it the other day, and I found this one section of recent sightings of wolfmen, real wolfmen. And I know you know exactly where I'm going. There's Polk County, Florida, Sparta, Tennessee, New York State, Central New York State, Southern Indiana, McHenry, mm-hmm. Illinois, Kilgore, Texas. And I was reading through all of these, and they seem to... And well, first off, it spans time, but they seem like they're describing the same exact creature.
Yeah, when it comes to the wolfman or the dogman, whatever you want to call it, they generally are. And I believe that it is the same creature, basically. The minor differences that you get are the same sort of fur color variations that you would see within any wolf pack. Any average wolf pack, they range from gray to kind of a dark shaggy brown. They look like either wolves or German shepherds is the most common description. So, and they behave, you know, very similarly wherever they are.
The other thing in your blog, which I want to get to next, is it was a pretty interesting story. The Uninvited. Slenderman, is there, do you think there's something, do you think there's a connection there?
Slenderman is something that I didn't even really hear about until those girls from near Milwaukee killed their friend over it. You know, it was something that was in a kind of a mutual horror blog where people would write in and make sort of fan stories, you know, out of this basic idea. So I don't know that I would connect that to anything, although it reminds me of various rumors about shadow people, these dark, generally slender figures that people will sometimes see out of the corner of their eye or sometimes lurking in the shadows. It reminded me of that really more than anything else.
Have you read the Slender Man stories?
No. I know this will strike people as funny, but I'm actually not a real horror fan. You know, when it comes to the things that are, you know, bloody and violent, the creatures that I write about and that people report to me don't do that kind of stuff, at least not that anyone lives to tell about it. You know, they're not, my books aren't gory. They're scary because people don't know what these creatures could do or might do, but they're not really in this horror genre.
Tell me about the Wampus Cat. This is image number 2 in your gallery.
Yeah, the Wampus Cat is the Native American version of something else that people have been reporting to me just over the past few years. And the Wampus Cat is a legend that occurs in several tribes down in the southeastern part of the country. And the legend is that, and there's slight variations of this, that there was a Native American woman who saw that the men were holding a tribal council, a secret tribal council out in the woods, and no women were allowed to be near it. And she was very curious. So she sneaked out there and was hiding and listening to their business. And when she was discovered, to punish her, she was turned into part cat, part woman. And so to this day, she still has to roam those woods and forests, wailing and, you know, looking and trying to survive somehow. And for some reason, it's called, and there are different variations to where the name came from too, the Wampus Cat. But it struck me as being very similar to certain reports that I've gotten. And I don't have a lot of these, but it does seem to be increasing. Some are from California. I have one from, I think it's Alabama again, where people say they saw something they describe as a dog cat, or one person described it as a Doberman lynx, where the creature stands up and it has these lynx-like ears and more of the rounded cat type of face and sort of a feline physique, but it stands up and also has dog-like characteristics. Now, you know, felines and canines are not supposed to be able to mate, so sometimes you can have one species have an adaptation that makes it sort of look like another species, and yet it really isn't mixed genes. It's just kind of a convergent adaptation of the same sort of features. Maybe that's what's going on. You know, I don't really know because there aren't enough examples to form a lot of opinions. But I did sort of link that to the idea of the Wampus Cat and wonder if that's maybe what was going on. Maybe this is something that's been around for a very long time and the legend evolved about it. And other people not knowing the legend are seeing the creature and giving it their own name.
Do you think they're extra dimensional?
I don't rule out anything like that because the cutting edge scientists today, our physicists, are telling us there could be other worlds within other dimensions. I have a great admiration for the late researcher John Keel, who talked about window areas, which he sort of described as places where the barriers between worlds grow thin and things can go in and come out. And that perhaps these other places are there all the time. We're usually just not aware of them. They're close enough to us that they have creatures that either can mimic our own or are rather like our own, and they like to come here for some reason. So I like to remain very open-minded when it comes to those ideas, because I think that believing all there is what we can tell with our main senses. You know, if I can't see it with my regular normal vision, hear it with my normal hearing, put my hands on it, it can't exist. I think that's kind of arrogant and leaves out, excuse me, things that are very well known, such as higher light frequencies, higher and lower sound frequencies. We know there are plenty of things that we can't see or feel. Electromagnetic radiation, you know, we're not aware of these things generally, but they're there. Maybe there are other things that are built to be aware of these types of different frequencies and to move around in them and have their existence in them.
These descriptions of these types of creatures, Egyptian hieroglyphs, ancient Chinese paintings, South America, cave walls in France, Greek legends and myths and stories, all pretty much describe the same creatures. They're seeing something and they're coming from somewhere, aren't they?
You know, it does seem that way. And the thing is, the earlier you go back to the Sumerians, they had something called Pazuzu, which was some kind of god. I think many people thought that it was a very scary type of god. But if you look at their old depictions of Pazuzu with these bat wings and this kind of scary furry creature in the middle, it looks a lot like what we call bat squatch, or the Jersey Devil, or gargoyles.
They're coming from somewhere. And right. when you have an ancient culture, and I say this a lot, Linda, but this is something that needs to be driven home for all of us that question things and look at things. When you take the time to carve into a rock for days or weeks, and you take the time to illustrate something on a cave wall, it was important to them. Right. When you take the time to, you know, create a piece of papyrus or some type of paper, and that paper is precious to you. You don't go to Office Depot and buy reams of paper 2,000 years ago. You know what I'm saying? Right. And so to document something like this, they were seeing something, and it was important to them. And to see it consistently happen over millennia to modern times, the exact same things are being seen. We are seeing something, and I just don't know where they're coming from. And extra dimensional is one of the answers.
Yeah, I think it's very tenable given the scientific research that's going on right now. And they're finding evidence for portals of different kinds, and then you've got black holes. You've got all different sorts of things that I don't purport to understand very well because I'm not a physicist. But you can find some really good books that do give you some idea. Brian Greene and Fred Allen Wolf are two that I like to read. And then there's another idea that some researchers that I know have kind of taken to, wherein they believe it's sort of like the old Gaia hypothesis, the idea that Earth has its own spirit or soul, and that there's this spirit matrix that's all over the globe that can interact with human consciousness, and that when this spirit entity that can sort of divide itself off and individualize according to what it wants to do, can interact with something in our consciousness, maybe ideas that we have or pictures that we have, that it can manifest as an actual creature. So when you think you're looking at a Jersey Devil, you're looking at something that has a different intelligence, perhaps connected to the Earth or somewhere else, has somehow made a connection with your mind and maybe used your energy too to manifest itself in a seemingly three-dimensional form that may be able to run around and pick things up and eat cats and, you know, do whatever. And that's another thing that you have to give thought to.
So you're saying that it would be maybe manifested from our own id, from our own fear or something that would be scary to us that we're projecting that and it's manifesting itself?
Well, possibly in conjunction with the theory goes, in conjunction with this already existing entity that is, you know, from the earth spirit. And I don't pretend to know how that works either, but that's kind of the general idea of it, that this other entity exists, is able to interact. It needs energy to manifest and perhaps to help shape its form, and that's what it gets from the human brain and the human consciousness and is able to come forth that way. So, you know, and that makes a lot of sense in many ways too, if you, you know, believe that there are other entities and spirit forms. And I know it seems to jibe with some biblical things.
In what way?
Well, you hear about spirits of the air, princes of the air, that there are entities, things that are looking to, I think one passage in the Bible says that the devil is like a prowling lion, you know, prowling around the earth seeking to see who it may devour. You get the idea that there are angels, there are all kinds of other spirit entities that are listed in the Bible that must be doing something, you know, and I don't know if that's natural that they're appearing as dogmen. I've had some people ask me, and again, this is just something they've asked, and I don't pretend to know, but they've suggested that, well, maybe we are in the end times, and the Bible talks about all these demons and creatures that are supposed to fight the final battle, and these are some of the gathering creatures. Who knows? You know, I think that's maybe a little more of a stretch than some of them, but it's something that different people have actually been asking me. So it's not my conclusion, but others have thought of it.
Do you think, we were talking earlier today about portals, and I want to get into that. And you said that you've been getting a lot of correspondence about portals. Is there a connection there too as well? Not necessarily extra dimensional, but are they traveling here from somewhere else? You know, I want you to answer that question. I'm going to lead into something else too as well. But sure. I think there is a connection. Do you think they're arriving, you know, and leaving?
Well, you know, it does seem that way in some cases. If you go back to your Skinwalker Ranch, there is a case where people saw portals. It looked like a hole in the sky and something came out. I've had different people report this. Sometimes people have seen UFOs come out of an opening in the sky that just appears suddenly and then closes up. I know people who say they have seen portals and that things have come in and out of them. So it's something that I'm looking into right now. And I'm actually looking for people who believe they have seen portals. And they sort of relate back in my mind to, if you go back to, let's say, England and Scotland, where they had this very strong lore and culture of the fairy world, and people would be taken into some sort of magical transformative place that might have been inside a hill or inside a cave, where they would find themselves suddenly in this fairyland, and they'd sort of lose all track of time, and when they came back, it might be 10 years later or 100 years later, they were taken to some place, they were transported to another world right adjacent to their own, where they came back and they had maybe not aged, but everybody else had. So I think that there's, I'm interested in correlations like that. I'll just say that.
Now, so for all of those listeners out there, a couple of instructions. If you have seen anything like that, a portal or anything, contact Linda directly through her website, which is, it's lindagodfrey.com, right? We have the links up at Jimmy Church
right.
Radio. Anything like that. Also, if you've seen anything at all like this, you know, Monsters in America, get the book. But if you've seen anything and you have a date, time, description, contact Linda. Contact her directly, and you can do it through our website. It's all there. I just got email or a tweet. Again, this is from Eugene. He's asking about the rake monster, and he's posted a picture. What do you know about the rake monster, R-A-K-E?
That is something I've heard of, but I'm sorry. I'm not really familiar with it, enough with that one to speak about it. There's so many monsters. Yeah, so many monsters, so little time.
How many emails how many emails do you get a day reporting a monster sighting?
Oh, it just depends. Sometimes I can get three or four. Sometimes it'll be a couple of days where I go in between. I'm thinking that the rake is sort of similar to the Slender Man. Am I right? That's what I'm...
He's looking... Well, the picture that I have here is small. No, he's white. He's got white glowing eyes. Skinny arms, but he's white, not black. If you know what I mean. Well, he's not a black shadow.
Then it's not what I'm, maybe not what I'm thinking of, but I remember seeing it compared to that in some way. But that's not one that's in my book or that I feel I've studied enough to talk about at great length. There's a lot of stuff out there.
One of our listeners, her name is Debbie, and she just reminded me of an experience that she spoke about on the air with us one night where she went through this... experience at Fort Laramie, and they were on vacation. She went up to a creek or a river. Her family's with her, and then there was like a temperature change, and she was looking across the river. And Debbie, if you want to call in, we'll take some calls here in about 10 minutes. If Linda, you wouldn't mind taking some calls, would you?
Sure.
Okay, we'll take some calls here. I'll open up the phone lines in 10 minutes. And Debbie said she was looking across the river, and she saw, again, I don't want to paraphrase or put words in her mouth, but it was pretty crazy. Like covered wagons, you know, smoke, some fires, families prepping the evening meal kind of thing, and saw people walking around. And like dozens, if not hundreds, of covered wagons, if I remember correctly. So anyway, she turns around to, you know, hey, check this out, you know, to talk to her family who's not there anymore. And the sign that was in front of her that was describing Fort Laramie and this point that they were at was no longer there. And then she turns back around and like the sign is back, you know, describing the scene where they're at. And across the river, the covered wagons were gone. And she just tweeted here, Jimmy, is that a portal like she's describing? You know, is that a portal?
That I think would be described as a time portal rather than, and of course, according to physicists, space and time are related. That's how you hear about space time. You know, used as almost an abbreviated word. And so some of these portals seem to be coming from other places. Some seem to be coming from other times. And that sounds like what this person experienced.
It's an amazing story. To hear her.
That's terrific.
Yeah. It's just absolutely fantastic. All right. Now, one of the things I just couldn't wait to talk to you about, and I just hope you have some information for us. What is it today with black-eyed children?
That's a really spooky thing.
Isn't it? Now, I'm a parent. You're a parent. Mm-hmm. And if you're going to freak out a parent, show them a picture of a black-eyed child. I mean, that is just one of the, you know, it's scary, it's creepy, it's nightmarish. And it seems to be all over the place right now. What is going on?
I think everybody's trying to figure that out. I mean, there are a lot of people who have studied them. Some people relate them to aliens. I don't know if that's the best case. What happens is people will encounter these young people. Sometimes they're fairly young, you know, 7, 8 years old. Sometimes they're almost more like teenagers. And they will, it seems often that they're trying to gain entrance, like to have you let them into your car or your home or whatever. They'll come to the door, ask if they can come in, and use your phone or whatever, and then you look in their eyes, and their eyes are just these solid black pools of, you know, shiny looking, strange, strange things. And then they just sort of, when they're not allowed in, they just sort of disappear into the night or wherever they came from. And I don't know that I've ever read that anybody has come up with a great explanation of them. It's kind of like they remind me sort of this. They have an alien-like quality to them. They have a fairy-like quality to them. They remind me of trickster fairies from the European cultures in some ways, because these, you know, the fairies were not these sweet, pretty little Tinkerbell things. They were often very dark, magical beings that would come and ask you for a cup of sugar or something, and if you didn't have them, give them the sugar, they would, you know, sour all your milk or make your only goat keel over or something. But they also had this strange look to them. They didn't quite look like normal human beings. So to me, it's sort of a variation on those as the closest kind of explanation. But that's still not saying where they come from. It's like there's this whole other realm. And as you said, your mind can't help but go to the idea of other dimensions or entities that, you know, are able to interact with our consciousness, something like that, because, you know, it's just
are they evil? Bizarre. Are they evil?
People that encounter them, in most of the ones that I've read about, seem to feel that they're evil. You know, they'll feel like they narrowly escaped having something really bad happen to them, because when they see their eyes, they're just so freaked out. And the children seem sort of non-emotional. They seem like they're not really cued into human social interactions, and that makes them seem weird too.
Are the reports, this is where I get freaked out when it comes to black-eyed children, is that the reports are that they are real. In other words, they're not ghosts. They're not a premonition. Yeah, they're an actual physical being.
Right. They seem solid.
And is that that's most of the reports that you've heard?
Well, they appear solid to people, but where they go, it almost seems like they slip away or they turn around in the garden. It's not like they see them vanishing. It's just like all of a sudden when they don't get what they want, they're gone.
I'm reading Twitter right now. What is the fae?
The fae is a word that refers to the entire kingdom of fairies, what they used to call fabulous animals or legendary animals, anything that would belong in the fairy kingdom. It can be applied more broadly to any strange entity, something not of this earth necessarily, something that's not human, not in the natural kingdom.
I don't pretend to know it all. And one of the best things about this show is I can learn something. I right now, after this show, I am going to go and search the fae tonight.
Just, you'll find a lot.
Okay, this is the fae has been portrayed. It says only recently that the fae have been portrayed as pleasant. The fae mm-hmm. could be brutal. I'm reading, these are tweets that are coming by.
Right. I think they're referring to, you know, like the fairies, goblins, brownies, leprechauns, you know, that sort of thing is where you see the term the fae applied to. And maybe black-eyed children fit in that same category.
Here's another tweet coming in. I think I just saw a black-eyed kid. It was in a crowd. Weird. Stared at me. Nobody else around seemed to see him. What about with the black-eyed children? Is it mainly at night, or are they seen during the day?
I've heard of incidents during the day. I think it's probably more common at night, but I have heard of incidents where people were just out somewhere and, you know, these two weird young people came up, and usually they've got, you don't see their eyes really clearly at first in many of the stories, and then they ask you for something, and then you see their eyes, or maybe you would just pass them by and notice all of a sudden that this thing, this person is staring at you, but their eyes are solid black, and it may only go that far in some cases.
Have you seen a black-eyed child yourself?
No, I have not. And I'm kind of glad that I have not.
I'm with you on that one, baby sister. I'm so with you. I do not. I've only had a couple of weird ghost things. I had one little sleep paralysis thing where I felt something in my room, or I saw something in my room at night. Everybody knows that story, famous story. I'm not going there right now. But I've had one ghost sighting where something was there. Something moved some curtains, and I saw a face from outside of my friend's house. And when they got home, her and her roommates and stuff, when they got home, I told them that somebody was in the house. We went in, you know, little two-bedroom house, not, you know, a small place. Nobody's there. And that freaked me out. To this day, I know what I saw. I saw what I saw, what I saw, what I saw, what I saw. What it was, I don't know. But I did see that. But if I saw a black-eyed child, I think I'd lose my mind. I mean, that's something that I don't ever want to encounter.
That's just too weird. Well, and it's partly the idea, I think, that if it's a child, you're supposed to feel protective and friendly toward it, but you can't because it's got monster eyes, you know. So right. What do you do with that? It's kind of like the Jersey Devil demon baby that, you know, jumps out of its mother's womb and murders the whole family. So it just makes everything it turns your mind around. It seems very twisted.
This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. We are kicking off Halloween week with Linda Godfrey. Monsters in America is her latest book. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Let's open up the phone lines. 323-825-5045. 323-825-5045. And, of course, you can Skype in, too, as well. Fade to Black 14. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. I'm clicking buttons right now and getting set up for this, Linda. I'm trying to do two things at one time. Okay, what I was going to bring up earlier is there a connection? And I feel sometime that there is. I actually have two questions. One, do you think there's a UFO ET connection to some of these monster sightings? And then I want to jump into David Icke and others like him that talk about reptilians. Yes. Okay, let's grab our first phone call. Here we go. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black. I think this is Dino. Dino, is that you?
Yeah, yes it is. How are you?
Say good evening,
Linda.
You say good evening to Linda. Okay, what do you got for us real quick, Dino?
Well, you know, we kind of crossed our minds here. That's what I was thinking. I'm not as up on the paranormal as on the extraterrestrial, but I do wonder about the black-eyed children and the connection about, it's sad, but I had a long-term friend abducted. Well, we don't know if he was abducted. He disappeared like at age 30, and I hadn't seen him in years and went and talked to his mother and said, well, he disappeared. No one's heard of him. And I've heard stories about all when they say that they abducted children and that they don't find them. There are several UFO researchers that say they're used for nefarious purposes on underground bases or brought elsewhere. And it makes me wonder when I hear about black-eyed children whether there's some kind of reprogrammed human form. I don't know. I just wondered Linda's thoughts on that.
That's a great question, Dino. Thank you, brother.
All right. Talk to you.
Yeah, that's scary, you know, and I don't know how you would ever go about verifying it. I will say that one thing the black-eyed children remind me of, because they've got these large, solid black eyes, is that's, of course, what the eyes of the gray aliens are supposed to look like. Mm-hmm. You know, the shiny black, kind of slightly slanted, sort of bulging black eyes. So there may be a connection there. But I'm not sure that there's any way of proving any other connection with alien abductions or any other sort of thing like that. And I, speaking of abductions, I noticed, I just did glance for a second at the Twitter feed, and somebody had asked several times about David Pilates and the missing persons.
I was going right there. I was going right there. You read my mind.
Okay.
I was going right there.
I'm glad. I didn't veer off the track. So, yeah. And I don't know. His books are fascinating. I've read his also his books on the Sasquatch, the Hoopa, that sort of thing. But he's very careful in his books not to say what he thinks is causing the abductions in the national parks and other places. And I always have to say, people say, well, do you think it's like the dog man? Could they be, you know, getting people? And I have to say that I've never been able to correlate any hot spots or sightings of the dog man with any unknown or abducted people. So adult or children in any way. So I just don't really have a way to know other than speculation. And you can, the speculation on that is all over the map. You know, some people will say, well, yeah, you've got, you know, the Dolce complex where it goes way, way down into the earth and they're doing all kinds of things to all kinds of humans. And then you'll find other people who say, no, there's proof that it's just a couple layers and it's more military. It's one of those questions that's just, in my mind, impossible to answer. You can look at what correlations there are and then speculate, but tantalizingly, again, never seem to be able to prove it.
Have you researched any UFO sightings that happen at the same time as a Bigfoot sighting?
Well, only sort of circumstantially, in that, you know, there would be a UFO sighting and then you would find out real close by there are lots of large unknown animal sightings in the same time frame. For instance, I had one from a woman who told me about, she's from the northern, very near the northern unit of the Kettle Moraine State Forest, and her family had a farm, and she'd been sent out, I think she was picking apples, and she was sitting up in this tree and saw a UFO come down and land and then got a very, very good look at it and take off again. And where that happened was right in the same territory where we had the goat man legend, where I've had numerous dog man type sightings and also Bigfoot sightings. She did not see a dog man or a Bigfoot or goat man coming out of that UFO, but there it was in this exact very same area. And I see that time and time again. There have been people who have said they've seen fur-covered humanoids coming out of UFOs. They're not very frequent, but it has happened. But more often, it's circumstantial. And it almost, again, relates to John Keel's window areas, where you've got the UFOs, you've got the animals. And Keel also said that even though he claimed that he interviewed somewhere around 100 witnesses for the Mothman in Point Pleasant, that the big story that people didn't notice was that at the same time and just before these Mothman things were occurring, there was a huge wave of UFO sightings, lots and lots of UFO sightings, and strange phenomena, you know, telephones not working and things like that were going on adjacent to the Mothman sightings. It doesn't say that the Mothman was coming out of the UFO, just that it somehow seemed that the phenomena were related.
Did you ever make it down to a Park Pleasant? Have you ever gone to the festival?
It's been on my list, but unfortunately, I just haven't had a year when I've been able to get there again. Usually in the fall is when I start getting really busy with my own appearances, and it also always seems that I've got a book deadline in September, which is when that wonderful festival is right. held. But again, it's the other thing, another thing on my bucket list.
That's one story. I think it's 100% true. It's one of those stories that it feels with all the eyewitness testimony and how it went down. It just feels right. I don't question it. I would love to go there for the festival. I would love to go and talk to some of the families and some of the experiencers out there. Very jealous, you know, Nick Redfern what's his name?
Yeah, me too. No, Nick's a friend of mine.
Yeah, Nick is great. And to go and hang out, because I would like to hear, you know, some of their testimony firsthand, because it just feels real to me. I don't question it. You know, I just feel it in my bones that event, well, and as tragic as the bridge was and everything, there was some serious tragedy there.
Right.
But I feel that event actually went down as, you know, it's so documented, you know, it's not like it's folklore of leprechauns coming out of Ireland. This is modern history here. And I feel that it really went down.
Well, there's a vast number of witnesses, and many of them are still, Linda Scarberry, one of the original witnesses, is still appearing on TV, and her story hasn't changed. There are tons of other witnesses, and then you've got all of this, you know, with the bridge actually going down, the terrible, horrible, tragic accident that happened, and all of the things that John Keel wrote about it. I mean, that man practically lived there for a couple of years, getting to know the whole place and every person. And, you know, now he never found any real hole in the story. I think he would have uncovered it if there was something to uncover. He just became more and more baffled by the whole thing.
I just have to say this. Ben Hur Asser, he's at Twitter. He says, "Tell Linda she has an amazing voice. It reminds me of dreams."
Whoa. Thank you. That's really cool. I'll take that as a compliment.
Check this out. This comes in from Donna Colvin. She says, "Has anyone noticed," and you need to comment on this because I didn't know about this, "has anyone noticed that black-eyed children have an odd accent? Have you heard reports of black-eyed children speaking?"
I have. Well, they have to speak because they ask people, you know, to come in, use their telephone, or can we come in your car? Can we take a ride? You know, they have the power of speech. But again, I don't know if it's that they sound, if the language is off, or if it's just partly because they have that social ineptitude that makes people kind of do a double take, you know, when they first talk to them. But they do have the power of speech, definitely. And I don't know if they have the accent or whatever. I had a weird experience once when I was out on Bray Road with a TV crew, and we were trying to film a little road just off of Bray Road, and this huge black, almost limousine, it wasn't quite, but a huge black car with tinted windows pulled up. And this lady, and it wasn't like anybody from around Elkhorn, I can tell you that. This lady with a thick Russian accent rolled down her window and looked at it. She was an older lady, very severe looking, gray hair. And she says, "May I help you with something?" It was just like a Boris and Natasha accent that I can't really do. And everybody said, "Well, no." And she looked around at everybody again and said, "May I help you with anything?" It was just so freaky.
Crazy.
Yeah, it was just so, it was.
What did she look like? What did she look like?
Well, I don't remember her having large black eyes, but she was like this late middle-aged lady with gray hair, kind of pulled back severely. And I remember her eyes as being sort of penetrating. I remember thinking, she's really scoping us all out. She's really looking at everybody. And why is she doing that? And she didn't want to take no for an answer that the producer didn't need her help with anything. You know, and here's this big honking black car. And everything was just so odd and out of place.
I wanted to ask you about, I don't know how to pronounce this, Wendigo? Is it Wendigo?
Wendigo.
Wendigo. I just sounded really dumb right there.
No,
Wendigo. Okay.
No, you didn't. Because Native American words are very often pronounced differently from one place to the other. It's almost impossible. That word is sometimes pronounced Wendigo, Wendigo. I've heard it Wendigo, Witiku. I mean, so don't feel bad. It could be a million different things.
This looks like the devil.
And it's a scary creature.
That is about as scary as it gets. That's what you, you know, when you want to get scared, that's what you picture in your mind's eye right there. But also, and this is Native American, correct?
Yes.
It's Native American, but it looks like it's a 2,000-year-old, you know, something from the Bible.
Yeah, there, and it comes in several different forms. It's a very widespread legendary monster among the northern tribes, especially in Canada and the Great Lakes areas. And what it has to do with is winter starvation. And it would often happen that when you're, you know, you're living in Canada or someplace, the game runs out in the winter, maybe you lost your underground vegetable storage and you're starving, and there are some people who are tempted to go Walking Dead. If anybody has seen the last few episodes of Walking Dead, you'll know what I mean, on their fellow tribes members. And there's the lowest form of it is when a person is said to be possessed by the Wendigo spirit, and they just remain like a normal human, except they have this propensity to want to eat their neighbors. And they are usually dispensed, the tribal have to get rid of them for the tribe's own good. Then there's another version where there's an actual spirit, where it's a spirit creature that they're dealing with that comes in the night. And then kind of the final version of it is that it's this 22-foot tall skeletal ice monster that has sort of evolved from, that's when you had a super successful possessed Wendigo spirit man who somehow, when they're able to finally kill it or get rid of it or whatever, or melt it down, in the very heart of it will be this little shriveled up human, or maybe the little shriveled up heart of the human, because I think that it maybe it symbolizes the coldness that it you have to take on to you know, want to devour your fellow man and become a cannibal. But it's a very widespread thing, and there are some places where they do believe that this is something that walks the land, and it's something that one reason I put it in the book is that more than many other Native American monsters, it's inspired. I know there's at least one movie called Wendigo, probably several. Lots and lots of fiction has been written drawing upon this Native American lore, and it's better known than many of the other Native American monsters.
Tell me about Gator Man. And we were and we were talking about David Icke earlier, you know, and reptilians. And that's about as old of a legend as there is. Tell us about Gator Man.
Gator Man is one of the creepiest things in my American Monsters books. It just freaked me out, and it's something that is actually still going on. I've sort of been following it with this particular eyewitness for 2 years now, and he's a person who is in the paleontological and zoological studies area in Florida, does a lot of time spends a lot of time boating and working on the St. John's River area over on the eastern side of Florida, which has all kinds of critters in it. And he started noticing at first things like he'd find a manatee, which was one of his study animals, that would be all bitten up on the flippers in ways that most animals can never do that to a manatee, because they're big, they're kind of tough. Things tend to leave them alone. And then he started catching glimpses of this weird, big, weird-looking alligator. Finally, he happened to be looking over in a mangrove swamp one day and saw this thing there, and it stood up. And he realized it had legs that could hold it enough to actually walk. I mean, alligators, they can rise up on their hind legs, but they aren't really made for walking a long way on or running on them. And he said this thing had longer, stronger legs and arms than you should see on any alligator. And not only that, it had a head. You might notice if you're looking at my drawing of it, He even gave me a good reference to look at. He said the head was more like that of a particular extinct species of alligator, which had more of a dome-shaped skull rather than the flat back that you normally see on an alligator, and monster teeth and that sort of thing. And this thing was looking at him, and it began to follow him around. At one point, he was out in a larger boat with a friend. He was kind of afraid that it might even try coming through a porthole or something like that. It has followed him to his home dock. And I kind of sort of jokingly said it reminds me of Captain Hook, you know, with the alligator following him around with the the clock in its stomach.
Right, right.
And I have kept in touch with him, and he hasn't seen it for a few months now, and is kind of hoping that it went away somewhere, because it's a very frightening thing. Just to be singled out by a recognizable single wild animal is one thing, but then when it's got this additional feature of being able to walk around on its hind legs when and doing things that it really shouldn't be able to do, you know, it's just sort of a freaky thing.
And what do you, and I'm looking at Lizard Man, Gator Man, the reptilians. Are you making a connection there? Because it's kind of obvious to me.
Yeah, you know, how can you not?
Right.
They all seem sort of like the same mold. Now, the Lizard Man is more of a, looks more like what you think of with the alien reptilians. It's got more of a humanoid face and form. It's got the kind of slanted, the reptilian slit pupils in the eyes. It has scales, webbed appendages, and often can snap wings out from behind its back and zoom away. That's another thing that's allegedly seen. The one that I made that drawing of happened to be inspired by a report where a man and his son were down by this river, the Mississippi River actually, looking for their lost dog, and heard kind of a weird noise and looked up and saw this thing standing dripping as if it had just jumped out of the water, right at the water's edge, staring at them in this grove of trees where the dog was lost. And luckily they did find the dog later. It had a happy ending, but I found it interesting that sort of in the same time frame, just up river, there's the Black River goes up toward Medford, Wisconsin from that area. And on Highway 13, a truckload of construction workers and separately a state patrol officer saw the same creature standing out in the middle of Highway 13. And each time it snapped a pair of wings out from behind its back and zoomed off.
Where, with Lizard Man, where are most of the sightings?
Well, the Midwest, the South seems to have a lot of them. There's the famous Lizard Man from Bishopville. Is it North Carolina? I always mix those up. Bishopville is North Carolina, right? Anyway, the Bishopville Lizard Man was another very, very famous incident where a young man got kind of stuck in a swamp and this thing came at him and clawed up his car, and he had to drive away with it sort of clinging to the hood of its car and, you know, maneuver the car so that it would roll off. Kind of like a action movie, it sounds like to me when I try and picture that. So the lizard men pop up here and there in just very odd places, and more often than you would think. And they don't seem the same to me as the other category of pig men, goat men, you know, that kind of thing. The lizard men seem like they're a consistent entity, and they're not coming out of some, you know, old hackneyed legend.
When you gather all of this information, where's the best evidence? Which one do we need to be? Which monster do we need to be on the lookout for?
Well, I really think that Bigfoot has to have the best evidence. I mean, there are so many footprints and casts, and it's grown pretty easy to tell the fake ones where you've got a rubber or a wooden model and you're just going around stamping it in the mud, versus where you can tell there's an actual flexible foot with dermal ridges, you know, the lines, kind of like fingerprints on the soles of your feet.
Right, right.
Theirs are different than ours. And you've got enough put together that people have at least tried to get DNA verification, and that's still going on. It's still controversial, but I don't think that we've seen the end of the DNA trials. You've got people who find hair from it and allegedly feces. And I know there was one Monster Quest episode where I thought this sounded kind of mean, but they put nails in a board hoping to rip some flesh from the creature's foot when it walked over it. And supposedly there was some with that. You've got the Patterson-Gimlin film, and I'm with you on that. That seems like it's the real deal to me. I've never seen another one where I could say that, because there are just so many ambiguous or obviously fake films or photos of Bigfoot. But there are so many that I think some of them have to be real, and the Patterson-Gimlin is really the star of the whole bunch. And then you've got sightings of these creatures. Now, on the first Monster Quest show that I was on, we rounded up a whole bunch of Dogman and Bigfoot witnesses, all the ones that I could get in one day from one certain area. They don't tell you that some of them are Bigfoot on the show. It was the one called American Werewolf. But we had a top-notch polygraph expert from Minnesota come in and administer the polygraph test to all of these people, and every single one of them passed with flying colors. You know, so you've got not just anecdotal evidence, but scientifically tested for at least they believe they experienced what they believe. They weren't making it up or trying to hoax anybody. You've got all of this going on. I really think the Bigfoot is his hands down got the best evidence and maybe the likeliest to get proven one of these days. Maybe somebody, these little drones or the eyeglasses that you wear on your the cameras that you wear in your eyeglasses, maybe people will start having more luck getting a picture.
Somebody just tweeted, the Patterson footage has me pretty convinced as well. That's from Letty. The thing is with the Patterson film, and I said this to Dr. Meldrum directly, if ufology had a piece of footage like the Patterson film, it would be case closed.
That could well be.
You know, it'd be over. We don't have that in not quite. We've got a lot of footage, but nothing quite like that. You know, a nice close-up, detailed piece of footage. With the Patterson film, you have that. What you don't have going along with the Patterson film is A, another piece of film, or B, we still don't have, you know, a body or a skull or anything to go along with that. It's just kind of funny to me. I mean, that Patterson footage, 100% authentic. There's no question about it.
Well, you can see the muscles moving under the skin.
Yes.
You know, and you just don't see that kind of thing in any sort of a fursuit, particularly with the kind of technology that was available in the 60s when that film was made. You know, and if you're looking at it, you can just see the musculature. I mean, my degrees in art had a lot of figure studies. And when you get to know human-like figures, you can see where the muscles are supposed to be. You can see if they're working. And you can see that this one has muscles that work a little differently than humans. It gives it a certain gait, and it gives, its proportions so differently. But you can still tell this is not a human in a monkey suit.
You said earlier you've made casts yourself of footprints.
I have. I don't have any really great ones. Most of the ones I've found have been in the Kettle Moraine on a slope where it's been running down and out of the cast. I've got photographs instead, but I've made some casts of some dogman prints that have been not too bad. The photographs of those are usually pretty good, though. For some reason, they show up a lot better. They're in different places. They're in cornfields and clay mud banks and things like that.
Somebody just tweeted, Bishopville is in South Carolina.
Thank you. Yes, I knew it was. I'm really direction dyslexic for some reason, and I have a really hard time with east and west and north and south, but thank you for. I knew it was one or the other.
Hey, our Twitter, our audience. Now I say it every night. They're smart.
They are sharp cookies.
Man, and Twitter's on fire. Okay, when I was growing up. Oh, by the way, this is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network, bespoke radio for the masses. Kickoff of Halloween week, we are speaking with Linda Godfrey. Monsters in America is her new book. If you want to go to her website, just click on name at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Take you straight over there. I think it is just LindaSGodfrey.com. Right, Linda?
It's actually LindaGodfrey.com.
Okay, no S. Okay.
No S in the website.
When I was growing up, now, I grew up in the Midwest, and there was a tweet about this, and I was going to ask you about this anyway. When I was growing up, there were all of these stories about giant birds, and there were reports, we would see them on the news once in a while, giant birds that shouldn't be there in Wisconsin, in northern Illinois. Indiana was another hot spot for giant birds and thunderbirds, and reports of this. What can you tell us about them?
Yeah, there's a lot more than you would think.
I know.
And they're still going on. Yeah, 1977. I don't know if that's when you were the era you were speaking about when you were growing up, but that there was a huge flap that year, and that was when these two gigantic birds were flying around over Lawndale, Illinois, and finally one of them swooped down and picked up this 10-year-old boy who weighed somewhere around 60 pounds and couldn't quite get him totally up airborne. And the boy's mother and his playmates and the boy were all screaming bloody murder. The bird finally dropped him and he was okay. But there was another group of kids that were also menaced by the two birds. And there was the same year there was a marabou stork that escaped from the Brookfield Zoo in Chicago. There were really strange birds seen all over the place, but I was really shocked when I received a report of one that happened I'm thinking it was 2005 up by Hayward, Wisconsin, right off the Mississippi Bluffs, where this man was named John Baldwin, and I think I've got one of his. Did I get one of his illustrations in there?
Let me check. I'll check. Go ahead.
Okay. Anyway, he sees this giant bird sitting in a meadow right next to where he's bicycling on a vacation in this nice resort area near Hayward. And he realizes that it's taller than him. And he's like 6'2", 6'3". I've met him. He's a very, very big, tall man. And because he could compare the height of the grass from where he was to where the bird was. And he laid his bicycle down and just went plunging into the grass. He was so entranced with this giant creature that was way too big to exist. It was like something out of a fairy tale or the movies. And he suddenly stopped cold, he said, because he realized, what if it was sitting on a nest? And it was angry that he was approaching. Just then, of course, it turned and looked at him. And luckily for him, began to try and take off rather than chase him. And he was watching it, trying to take off, getting air under its wings. The wings are billowing. And it finally gets airborne and flew over the road for a ways, maybe because there was less drag or something with the asphalt road that he'd been bicycling on. And when it did that, it was low enough that he could see its wingspan was as wide as the road. And when I went up there and met with him and he showed me the spot, I measured the road and it was about 20 feet wide.
That's right.
Average.
I remember the story. 20-foot wingspan, over 20 feet.
Oh, it really was, yeah. And it was continuing down this road. And the oddest thing was this little community had its own airport. And he expected that somebody would have seen it on radar or someone else would have seen it. But he was never able to find anyone else that had any clue that it was there. But it's one of the best large bird sightings because when most of them are just people looking up in the air and seeing something up there, and then there's nothing to gauge against to tell exactly how big it is. Here, he saw it on the ground, was able to gauge its size, was able to see how it took wing and observe how its wings worked, and then also got to see it fly off. So he kind of had the whole smear there. And he says that it's changed his life because he knows it's something that just is not believed to exist, and yet he experienced it, a full experience in full daylight, and he knows it's there, and you know, was willing to give his whole name, and he says, I can't, you know, say that I didn't see it. I saw what I saw, and that's that.
323-825-5045. We only have a few minutes left with Linda. I'm sorry I didn't pick up those phone calls, but when she's speaking, I'm not going to interrupt. So everybody that just called in, just call back. 323-825-5045. We'll squeeze in a couple of more. Thank you, Linda, for hanging on with us for a couple of minutes. I want to get to a couple of other things. One is the monster dragon picture. And for everybody, this picture is one, two, three, fourth in the second row in the gallery. And this is the only picture that you didn't draw. This is an eyewitness drawing. Tell us about this.
Yeah, that happened in the little town of Oconto Falls. And I don't want to give people the impression that every story in American Monsters happens in Wisconsin. It's just that certain ones, I don't know, I seem to pick them out from the pile for the pictures tonight. But Oconto Falls is a very small town near Green Bay, Wisconsin. And the story first came to me from a young man who had been at a concert. And it's such a small town that he and his friends went from the concert to his house and were lying out, just kind of looking up at the stars. You know, they weren't drinking or anything like that. And they saw this creature fly over. There were several smaller ones, but the biggest creature was the one they got a really good look at. And it was flying so low, they could see its scales on its stomach reflected in the streetlight. And they could tell the individual scales. The only thing they could come up with was that it looked like a dragon to them. And he had gone in the house and gotten his mother and his sister to come out. And they both gave me individual versions of the story, corroborated exactly what the first witness said. And I think it was the mother that actually drew this picture that you saw. They went one way over this area, and then it was like they turned around and came back the other way. So they actually got to see them twice. And it appeared that they might have at some point what looked like fireballs coming from their mouths. They weren't sure what that phenomena was, but that was how it appeared to them. And none of them could think of any other phrase that really fit them other than dragon. They reminded them of medieval style dragons. And in fact, the sister was almost upset that the family had talked about it, because she felt that they were almost a sacred, really special sort of thing. And she didn't want people to ever make fun of them or anything like that. But they were all extremely impressed by the reality of these creatures.
How big was it?
I'm trying to remember offhand. It seems like they were, and again, these were against the sky, so they didn't have anything to gauge it by, but I'm thinking they were like 10 feet, something like that, was what they had said.
Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Linda Godfrey. Who's calling? Where are you calling from? You're live right now.
I'm here.
Yes, you are live.
I hope so. Hang on here.
Hello, are you there?
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. By the way, Jimmy, I just want to correct you one thing. He stated with her tonight, you never have grown up, Jimmy.
thank you, Star. How are you tonight?
Oh, I'm wonderful. Boy, she just snagged me tonight. I'm going to tell you, all you Vader Nats, you are really being treated tonight, because this lady is talking about a subject that I've kind of had a taste of down in Peru. And one of the things about big birds, boy, they do get big. And there's been legends, of course, and yes, and I realize everybody's looking for bones, blood, and hair. However, if you're looking for anything big, dig around Peru for a while. Everything's big down there, and there's a reason for it. But one of the things about big birds is that they live in the most isolated places, and the odds of running into one are just really zilch. And so what she's explaining makes absolute sense. In other words, discovery by happenstance, verification photographically is absolutely easy because of their size. And that this particular thing, forgetting the bird for the moment, Bigfoot, for example, those little details about muscles moving underneath the flesh, those are very critical little things. And I just want everybody to understand that she's got a tough subject, and she's doing a very good job, and that's only because she's on the Jimmy Church Show. Have a good evening.
Thank you, Star.
Thank you.
Oh, you're always welcome. And Karen, keep it up. Oops, sorry, wrong name.
Linda. Linda.
Linda, sorry.
I knew you meant Linda. Thank you for that anyway.
Star Six is just blaming everything on his last birthday. Bye-bye.
Bye. You know, he actually brings up two or three really, really, really good points. Number one, the California condors in general, remember, thought to be extinct, could never find them. Well, I don't know if they were ever thought to be extinct, but certainly not. We couldn't find them. And they live in the most remote places, and they are huge birds. And to find one and to photograph one is nearly impossible. I mean, it's been done now. We've gone out and searched for them. But he's absolutely right. These big birds live in the most remote places, and they avoid us.
Right, right. And, you know, I actually had this thought when I was researching these. I realized that a lot of the sightings in the 70s occurred at the same time they were really starting to break through the superhighway in the South American rainforest. And so when he mentioned Peru, that kind of brought that back to my mind. But I noted in the book, I said, what if this construction disturbed or routed out some of these large birds? If you were going to hide out someplace, what better place than these vast rainforests where it's almost, you know, impossible for people to go in a lot of the areas? And then suddenly you're disturbed. So you head up the Mississippi because there's a place where you've got cliffs and drafts and water. And you can maybe make your way to another less inhabited place.
You know, with all of your walking in the forest, in the woods, and I was thinking about this when we were talking earlier, in all of my walks through the woods, camping, whatever, I don't think I've ever come across a carcass, not even like a squirrel, you know? I mean, yeah. I don't think I ever have. That kind of makes me want to just scratch my head because that's one of my own arguments when it comes to this.
Sure.
But I don't think I ever have.
I've seen deer carcasses just in odd places, you know. And maybe a raccoon or two. Well, of course, you see roadkill.
Right. Well, yeah. Roadkill aside.
Roadkill aside. But just in the woods, I've seen a couple of deer carcasses in, as I said, in odd places, but that's about it.
Why would you find a deer carcass?
I don't know. You know, I did find one when a friend and I were over investigating a sighting in the Bark River near Whitewater, and we were walking around, and there was just this really gory-looking deer carcass. Sometimes it's poachers will leave them.
Okay.
So you just never know. And I actually found one when I was investigating the man bat in La Crosse, Wisconsin. When the witness pointed out where it sailed away into the trees, I looked over in the trees, and there was a deer carcass.
Oh, wow, that's weird.
Yeah, partly gone, lying right there. So those are the two times.
One last thing before we wind things down, and again, thank you. Fascinating show, always. I'm just I'm having so much fun. Lake monsters. Now, lots of reports across the United States. Of course, you know, we all know about Nessie. Oh, by the way, did you hear that there's supposed to be some underwater sonar photography that's going to be revealed this week with Nessie? Have you heard about this?
Yeah. I'm kind of waiting for that.
Yeah, I'm waiting for it, too. We're all on pins and needles. I hope we're not let down.
Yeah, I don't. I've learned I don't get my hopes up real high anymore because I've heard this before. You know, so often people are promising this big reveal and it doesn't pan out. So I'm hoping this will be the different new one. But who knows?
Now, what about the United States? What's the best lake monster that we have?
Well, hands down, I really believe that it's the Flathead Lake Monster in Montana. There's a man, Laney Hansel is his name, who is a I think he was with the Fish and Wildlife Service, who was professionally monitoring the lake for many, many years and keeping track of the monster sightings. And he's personally recorded well over 100 sightings. And the sightings go back to the 1800s. So you've got sightings happening for a long time. They're still happening. They're being recorded by a professional. You've got people of all stripes and sizes and ages having all kinds of different encounters with this creature. And it seems like there's actually two kinds. There's one that's like the standard serpent-like sea monster. And then there also may be a really huge old sturgeon, which, you know, sturgeons are almost they're prehistoric in their life. They've been around forever. And they look like monsters, too, if you're not very familiar with what they look like. So Flathead Lake, I think, has to be one of the best, if not the best.
How big is the lake? I'm looking at pictures of it here. It's pretty big.
Yeah, it's very large. And again, I don't have the exact size of it miles right in front of me, but it is very, very large. And so it's not one of these tiny lakes where somebody could say, well, there can never be anything living in there. It may not be able to hold very many things, but it's large enough that it might be, if it can support giant sturgeons, which people will accept, maybe it could also support these other more unknown-looking creatures.
That is just, yeah, I'm looking at some of these pictures here on the internet. Wow, I didn't realize that lake was that big. I mean, it's pretty, that's a big piece of water.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, when it's got its own fish and wildlife employee, and it's a well-known vacation spot, too. I mean, a lot of people come there, and so you've got this happy coincidence of lots of frolicking tourists furnishing eyewitnesses. Because if you're going to have sightings of any creature, you not only need the creature, you need people who are coming and able to see the creature and then report it.
What about the Hawaiian legends about the night marchers? I'm going to pronounce this wrong. Menehune?
The little people?
I'm just reading the question. And this is from Hawaii. And I know I'm butchering this. I feel so bad. Menehune.
Yeah, I think you're saying that word real well. And I've had some neat stories from Hawaii. I haven't had too many personal reports about the Menehune, and I'm not sure that I could speak too well about them. I do know that there are a lot of little people stories from Hawaii that resemble Native American stories of little people. It's a very widespread idea, if I'm correct about that. And I don't want to misspeak on the Menehune. The little people may be something entirely different. But I did have a really wonderful story about a girl who found herself lost in the woods in Hawaii, which you don't usually think of there being wooded areas, but there are some. And it getting chilly at night, and she couldn't find her way out. And werewolf-like creatures surrounded her and actually kept her warm and led her toward the opening to find her way out in the morning. And she swears, you know, she felt them. They had fur. It was not a hallucination. She wasn't, you know, that far gone that she was, you know, overly cold or anything like that. But there are some lovely stories with these dog creatures, too, every once in a while. They're not all terribly scary.
Halloween, is it your favorite time of year?
Yes and no.
I mean,
I love autumn. I really love autumn because the mosquitoes are dead. And that's my biggest first and foremost. But I love the colors. I love the trees. I love that the foliage kind of dies back and you can actually see the structure, the skeleton of the woods, you know, as it were, all the bare branches. You can walk in them more easily again. And Halloween is a fun time. Unfortunately, nowadays, I often am very, very busy during the Halloween week, so I don't get to enjoy much of the other things. But, yeah, it's a very fun time of year.
I'm reading these tweets, okay? This is how it's going. Another hour, please. I can't believe this show is coming to an end. We demand another. These are different tweets. I'm demanding another hour. Can you ask? Can you do another hour? Linda, you are the best. Don't leave. Actually, feeling kind of sad. The show is ending. Such a great show with Linda. I could listen to 12 more hours. Just one after another, and another hour. Just
you have the greatest people.
This show is it's a humbling experience every single night. I say humbling so much because it's always like this. And when I have somebody on, well, every guest is the same. There's only been maybe one exception in the last year. It's all about hanging out, talking. I don't have questions. I don't have an agenda. Let's just sit down and talk and let everybody just hang out and enjoy the conversation with us. And they get that. And if I learn something, maybe you'll learn something. But if I learn something, then they do too. And if it's interesting for you and I, was it interesting, Linda?
It was very interesting. I mean, it works really well, and I just enjoyed myself.
Yeah, and it the energy flows. It just goes, you know, and everybody gets it. And I just had a wonderful time tonight.
Me too.
Just absolutely riveting. We have another live show right after this. Otherwise, I would talk the network into letting you stay up till about 4 o'clock in the morning.
Well, I can come back.
Yeah, absolutely. You're coming back. I cannot wait for that. So what have you got going on? Now, tomorrow night you're speaking. Where's that?
Tomorrow night I'm speaking at the Beloit Public Library. Beloit is right on the Wisconsin. Remember we were talking about that border, the Wisconsin-Illinois border, right in the center of the two states, but on the border. And I'll be giving a talk and a signing on American Monsters. And then I'm heading up to a beautiful Northwoods Lodge called Eagle Waters in Eagle River, where I'll be doing a conference with a dinner talk and a really nice chance to hang out with like-minded people, some other really great people up there. A few other things.
Any new books coming out?
Well, I just signed the deal memo for my next book, and it won't be out probably for at least a year. These tend to take a little bit. But I am also working on, if anybody likes my style of writing and they like fantasy, I do have a fantasy novel that is available on Kindle and other ebook venues, and you can go to lindagodfrey.com. And look at the page that says God Johnson, The Unforgiven Diary.
Oh, I wanted to get into God Johnson. I can't believe we let that go.
Oh, another show.
Yeah. Now.
But there's a page on my website if you're curious. And, I love to get feedback on that. And I'm halfway through the sequel to that one.
And again, anybody has any sightings, any stories, anything that you would like to do, just contact Linda directly. You can do that through her website.
Please.
And also portals. She's collecting information and witness stuff on portals. That's one of the things that she's researching currently. So I'm putting that out to everybody. Thank you, Linda. I just had a great night. What a great way to kick off Halloween. Thank you very much.
It went so fast.
It did, didn't it? Again.
It did. I think it was a time portal that we wandered into.
It was a time warp. I just looked at my watch.
Time warp.
Yeah, only 5 minutes went by. Thank you, Linda. You have a great night.
You're welcome. You too.
Bye-bye.
And thanks to all your listeners.
Hey, you got it. Check your Twitter out. We're going to Twitter bomb you right now.
Oh, that's great. I'm looking at it right now. So thanks again.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Linda. Good night.
Good night.
Linda Godfrey, and that's the way we're going to kick off Halloween week. Absolutely amazing. Now, I want everybody to retweet. I'm going to do this in real time. This is live radio. Here we go. Twitter bomb thank yous to at. Wow, I'm doing this in real time. Linda S. Godfrey, right there. Everybody, go say thank you to Linda. Okay, let me just get the rest of this out. And that's how we do it. That's how we do it. If we didn't have another show coming up next, I would have definitely talked her into to hanging out with us. But I want everybody to Twitter bomb thank you, Linda, right now. There it is. Retweet. Get it into her Twitter box right there and thank her. That was an absolutely extraordinary show. Oh, man. So we are winding things down. We are done. Tomorrow night, let's not forget, Father Ashcraft will be with us. It'll be exorcism night tomorrow night. And I had a bunch of email I was going to try to get to. That's what I'm talking about. For everybody right now that's listening to this show, at J Church Radio, hashtag DM Radio Net. Watch what just happened right now in the Twitterverse. That makes my life complete, watching that happen. Come follow us on Twitter, at J Church Radio. If you have any guests, by the way, that you would like to have on the show, everybody on the show, pretty much everybody that's on the show, is a request from you, from the Fader Knots. Send me an email, jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Send us your guest request, okay? We have nothing but the very, very best and the brightest on this show. If there's somebody that you want on the show, email me. How do you think Linda Godfrey got to us? That was a request from you, okay? Always remember that. Jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. You can also go over to the contact page and email us directly through there, too, as well. Again, follow us on Twitter, at JChurchRadio. Hashtag DM Radio Net. Tomorrow night, Father Ashcraft, exorcisms. Wednesday is Ouija board night with Tracy Twyman. Also, I think we're going to have a very special guest. We're going to do a live Ouija board YouTube simulcast. We will actually do it live. The Ouija board is not going to be here in this studio. I would never do it. That is just asking. That is asking for the wrong stuff. You know my beliefs on that, but we're going to do it freely over there. Hey, look, Linda just tweeted in. Thank you so much. Absolutely, Linda. That was you are the best. Thank you for that. And then Thursday night, Sha will be in here doing live readings all night with you on Fader Night. This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. Thank you, Linda. Had an amazing time. Can't wait to get you back. And thank you for Dino for calling in tonight. Stay tuned. Coming up next is The Unexplained. Special thanks to Keith Rowland and Art Bell. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Kamarian. Show's produced by Hilton J. Palm and Mark D. Kovar. Special thanks to Leslie Johnson III. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vito, and Mark D. Kovar. Fady by Dale, graphics by Method, music by Doug Aldridge, intro by Spaceboy. Oh, go check out spaceboymusic.com. Spaceboymusic.com. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your humble host, Jimmy Church. Everybody be safe. I'll see you tomorrow night for a continuation of Halloween week right here on the Dark Matter Radio Network. See ya!